the 295th consecutive sellout, and you couldn't ask for a better day to play football. This afternoon in Lincoln, Nebraska, we have the Baylor Bears taking on the Cornhuskers of Nebraska. Hello again, everybody. Along with Kelly Stauffer, I'm Ron Fielding. Kelly, we're about halfway over, just over halfway through the season, and this is the time of year where coaches begin to evaluate where their teams are as far as the conference standings and also bowl possibilities. Now, if you're Nebraska, the way they played the last 2 weeks has really given this team some hope.
It really has, and you're right. Both teams are looking for that sixth win as a minimum. Nebraska wants to maintain the momentum. Baylor wants to find a way to get the momentum. It's going to be tough in front of this crowd here today.
Now, for both teams, they are similar because the success of their team depends on their quarterback, and both are very skillful, but both do it different ways.
Yeah, opposite ends of the spectrum. It seems like Joe Gans has been here for a long time, but actually, it's been 10 starts. Today, his 11th. He's been very efficient, much more comfortable because the game plan reflects what Joe Gans brings to the table. He's been incredibly efficient this year.
Now, on the other side of the football, we have probably the most exciting freshman in college football right now, Robert Griffin.
Yeah, 155 pass attempts without a mistake. But it's a reflection of Art Broyles' offense early in this guy's career. But when it gets electric is when Robert Griffin wants to run the football. Then watch out.
Let me tell you something. Nebraska, they've got their attention focused on Robert Griffin. This is only the 11th meeting between these two teams. Nebraska's only lost once. That was back in 1956. Opening kickoff coming up straight ahead.
College football on Versus is brought to you by the Volkswagen Ruthan, the only minivan in America with German engineering. And by Under Armour Performance Trainers, the first pure performance training footwear at the Sports Authority.
All right, thanks so much, Ted. We'll be checking back with you, College Football Central on Versus throughout the day. It is a beautiful day here, so let's go down to the field and check out the Under Armour Click Clack Cam.
The last sound you hear before you step on the field. Click Clack. I think the hero's coming.
Come the Nebraska Cornhuskers. They are ready for today. It's a beautiful day, sunny, 51 degrees, expecting to get up in the upper 60s. And they are an inspired team. With more on that, the third member of our team, Lewis Johnson.
That's right, Ron. Each week, Nebraska head coach Bo Pelini gives his players a special quote for the weekend. In the past, he's used words from Alexander the Great to Michael Jordan. But this week, the quote is from his hero, his dad, Anthony Pelini, who at the moment is in a hospital in Akron, Ohio. And here's the quote. You are who you are when no one is watching. Now, Bo reflected with us back to the moment when he heard his dad say that. He was a young kid growing up in Youngstown, Ohio, and his dad was always on him about practicing, working on what you love. Now, one day his dad came home from work and said, hey, Bo, did you practice those free throws today? And then came the statement, because you are who you are when no one is watching. Pelini is using that quote this weekend to try and inspire his team and the lesson from his ailing father in his first season as his head coach in Nebraska. And you think about Bo and his brother Carl, who is also on the staff here. They're hoping that the players exemplify that during the week so that they can have success on the weekend, like right now against Baylor. Ron?
All right, thanks so much, Carl Pelini, an outstanding coach. And the Baylor fans and the Nebraska fans are ready. Baylor won the toss. They've deferred. Kicking off for them is a true freshman out of Argyle, Texas, Ben Parks. Only two touchbacks and only a 9-mile-an-hour win, and it's moving from right to left, but Parks has the ball being affected by the wind. Back to receive the kick, Alfonso Denard, an exciting freshman out of Rochelle, Georgia, and Niles Paul. And there's Niles Paul already, one touchdown, returned one 85 yards versus San Jose State earlier this year, and again the ball falls off the tee.
Here comes the mandatory holder on. The ball goes off the tee twice in a row. Jordan Lake is the guy that's going to put his finger on it. And hopefully we can get this thing kicked off.
And now we are set. Underway from Lincoln, Nebraska. And it's going to be Paul. He stood up right at the 20-yard line and pushed back. That's where Nebraska will take over. First and 10. Last two games, this Husker offense has been outstanding. They've dominated time of possession the last couple of games. And one of the reasons the play of their quarterback, Joe Gans, six 300-yard pass games in his career. He has made incredible decisions, though, Kelly, the last two games.
Yeah, and I think that's the key right there, Ron. The decision-making with Joe Gans. He was pretty effective last year, but it's gone up several notches this year, well over 70%. Great decision-making.
And we see Nebraska spreading the field again. After the Missouri game, they realized who they were was a spread team. The quick out pattern up to the 25 to the 26 yard line is Nate Swift, and he continues to fight his way. And the offensive line for the Nebraska Cornhuskers. Smith will get the start at left tackle. Well, he's going to be sharing time with Javorio Brooks or Burks. And in the skill positions, keep an eye on Swift and Peterson. They have really been in sync with Joe Gans this year. Lucky has also been solid the last couple of games. Pickup of 7 on the play, 2nd and 3 from the 28. First possession of the ball game for the Nebraska Cornhuskers. Gans keeps it, runs the options, got the first down and some running room. Up over the 45-yard line to the 46-yard line before Jordan Lake trips him up.
This is the zone read option out of the spread structure. This is what's new recently. You can see right there the zone read inside. They take Lucky right there, the defender from Baylor, and then Gans pulls it and gets around the corner. He had a pitch guy in relationship as well. But this is the new wrinkle that Sean Watson has gone to. Get Gans in shotgun and let him utilize that mobility a little bit more.
He had a 33-yard run earlier this year. He says he likes running the option. His speed is deceiving. First down for Nebraska. Pressure comes. Gans out in the flat. Wide open is Swift. He makes it up to midfield and gets into Baylor territory. The Baylor defense, they forced 14 turnovers this year, 2nd in the Big 12 in turnover margin. On the line, the guys in the middle, Brian and Rhodes, they do a good job clogging up the middle. That opens it up for an outstanding linebacker crew. They've combined for over 170 tackles already this year. Joe Pavelic in the middle, All-American candidate. Dinged up in the secondary, Dwayne Crawford is out. Jordan Lake at free safety. We're going to call his name a lot. He is one of the best tacklers in the conference. Pick up a 5 on first down, 2nd and 5. Gans swings it out, holds. Can't hold on to it, pass is incomplete.
And you're going to see a lot of Holt today as well. Holt is that third wide receiver that has really blossomed. He can take over the X position, and that means Nate Swift can go back into the slot where Nate Swift has been more effective throughout his career here at Nebraska.
You know, we talked about after the Missouri game, Sean Watson said halftime of that game, he knew what they had to do. He watched the tape 3 times on Sunday. They've junked the heavy sets, basically. Yeah. They want to spread people out.
Yeah, he said, we're not a power running football team. The spread structure is in vogue here in Lincoln, and I think that plays to Gans' strength.
Absolutely. Baylor trying to bring pressure. Gans steps up in the pocket. Crossing pattern complete. Down to the 46-yard line to Niles Paul, his 12th reception of the year.
Quick early decision, and you see just the flat route coming inside with Niles Paul. Comes up just a little bit short. You don't necessarily have to take that first down depth, because with that route you're expecting yards after the catch. Paul just did not get much on that play.
Well, he came up about a yard short. Dan Titchener, they've been alternating punters with Titchener and Wesch. This is interesting because Nebraska is 118th in net putting. Baylor 118th in punt returns.
Well, this is going to help.
Oh, it catches a divot right at the 5-yard line. 37 yards on the kick, an outstanding kick for the senior out of Cheyenne, Wyoming. Let's take a look at the Craftsman tools for success.
Well, Ron, for Baylor, they need to create momentum and then maintain momentum throughout this game and then capitalize. When you have an opportunity to make a play, you have to seize the moment. Nebraska, take away the short passing game, because that's how Art Briles protects his young quarterback, and then keep that young quarterback who's electric with his feet, Robert Griffin, keep him in the pocket.
We are going to see the spread formation as we've not seen it. Art Briles doesn't like to call it a spread, but when you have Geddes, the top of your screen, way over to the sideline, we have a penalty flag. That's called a spread.
Illegal substitution against the offense. 5-yard penalty. Remains first down.
Well, Ron, if you're looking to get the young quarterback comfortable on the road in front of about 88,000 screaming red fans,
remains first down.
It's not the way to do it, getting backed up early.
Absolutely. There's a good look at Robert Griffin, originally committed to Houston, but when Art Briles took the head coaching position at Baylor, he called him and said, I want to come to Baylor with you. First down and 14 from the 4-yard line. Kendall Wright dancing around in the backfield. Griffin, a simple pass to Wright. And he is going to barely get back to the line of scrimmage. Good defensive play. This Baylor offense, as we mentioned, third best in the Big 12 in rushing. The line, over 100 career starts between the starters. Jason Smith is the bell cow there. This skill position, slew of wide receivers going to play, but Kendall Wright, we just saw, he's one of six freshmen in the country to have 30-plus receptions. From the shotgun on second and 14. Straight ahead running, nothing doing. And Dominican Sue, the junior out of Portland, Oregon, with his 35th tackle, as we take a look at this defensive line, coming off a solid performance against Iowa State. This is where the success starts with Potter, Sue, Steinkuhler, and Allen. Linebackers, Cody Allen didn't play against Texas Tech, but came back with five tackles versus Iowa State last week. And the DBs, West O'Hanlon, Asante, and Murillo. Third down and 14, and two plays, no gain.
And if you're Baylor right here, you do not want to make a mistake early. You want to create momentum, but not at the risk of a big mistake here early in this game.
Griffin tries to get to the outside. He's able to pick up a couple, but Armando Murillo coming up from that quarterback spot to make the stop. Good first impression by this Nebraska defense.
And Ron, what a difference a year makes. We were in here a couple times last season, and that defensive front from Nebraska was much maligned. They were nicked up and injured, but as Steinkuhler and Sue have gotten healthy, put them in with Potter and Allen, this group up front is active and productive.
Well, now Derek Epperson out of Southlake, Texas, Keller High School, standing in his own end zone, set to kick it away. No pressure, and he gets off a dandy. Back at the 42-yard line, it's Niles Paul, slips through the first wave. And he is in the Baylor territory. They'll mark it down at about the 39-yard line. Jordan Lake on the stop, but Nebraska with outstanding field position here in the first. Baylor Bears 0-2 on the road this year. They've lost six straight road games, eight straight road games in Big 12 play. They're scoreless in the first. Nebraska, they've lost two home games this year. They have not lost three consecutive home losses since 68. Virginia Tech and Missouri, two in a row. Joe Gans wants to change all that. They've got great field position. First and 10 on Baylor's 39-yard line. A couple of tight ends, one back. Lucky. Very patient, wanting the football, gets inside the 30-yard line. Jeremy Williams took his legs from underneath him.
Ron, we've already seen that what Sean Watson refers to, that spread structure, and then they use multiple formations and personnel groupings. They bring guys, they've already had two running backs, single running backs, three, four wides, double tight end on that play, and look for early in this game for Nebraska to kind of get that offensive line lathered up a little bit and run right at this Baylor front.
Now they're going with a four wide receiver set. Chris Brooks, top of your screen. Gans play action. Baylor closing quickly, and they do. Down to the 28-yard line is Nate Swift, and we have a penalty play.
I think that ball came out, Ron. I don't know if they're going to call it down or not, but.
Well, there's no penalty flag. He picked it up.
And Nate Swift is that target guy, as offensive coordinator Sean Watson referred to him. They want to get him the ball any and every way they can. Watch the ball right at the end as the Baylor defensive back goes to slam him down. The referee said that Nate Swift was on the ground before we saw that ball come out.
Nate Swift, three catches already. He needs four to tie Johnny Rogers' all-time receptions in Nebraska history. And it's first and 10 from the 29. Gans on the option. Lucky gets a block on the outside. He's going down the sideline. Hesitates a little bit, but not before he gets another first down and gets inside the 20 down to the 15-yard line. Jake Lamar, the senior out of Bedford, Texas, stopped him.
Nebraska fans are familiar with this play. Just a speed option to the left side. Joe Gans just goes immediately to the end man on the line of scrimmage. Defensive end takes Gans. He pitches it to Lucky. And that's where Lucky, Ron, is at his best, is out in space. I question whether he runs it effectively between the tackles. But out in space, he's very effective.
Once again, Joe Gans getting in rhythm in this Nebraska offense, getting in rhythm early. This time Baylor's front four steps up to the challenge. That'll be no gain on the play. If it is, maybe just a little bit. Marlon Lucky, the ball carrier. Zach Scott, the redshirt freshman out of Cypress Creek High School in Houston, on the stop. Good look at him.
You know, Ron, think back to that potential fumble by Nate Swift at the end of the play a couple of plays ago. That's what Nebraska's been doing. They've been putting the ball on the ground three times last week against Iowa State in the first drive. The third one was finally coughed up for the turnover. They have to protect the football.
Interesting formation again for Nebraska. Three wide receivers to the right. Gans pump fakes. Oh, he's got a lot of room. Cuts back inside, inside the 10, down to the 7-yard line. Jordan Lake already five tackles in this ball game. That'll set up a third down and short.
Reason Gant gets out of the pocket, obviously nothing is downfield, but it's also man-to-man coverage. Man-to-man coverage, when the quarterback breaks contain, there's nothing but running room, and Gans has the mobility to take full advantage of that.
Third down, just over a yard. And they'll go from the I formation. Gans under center, Lucky and Lawson in the eye.
And this is the heavy side over on this side with Murtha and Lawson.
And he looks to throw, looking for six, wide open. Touchdown, Nebraska. Catch of the year, first touchdown of his career. He's a redshirt freshman. And the crowd of 84,000, I think they just let go 84,000 balloons. It's an incredible sight. And they will try the extra point. Alex Henry. He remains perfect this year.
Well, Ron, we talked about Nebraska wanting to get momentum early and maintain it. Ryan Hill is the receiver on the right side, just slips underneath. Great start if you're a Cornhusker fan.
Joe Gans, 32 career touchdown passes. He now ties Jerry Tagge and Vince Ferragamo for number five in Nebraska history. And his Huskers lead is 7-0. That is his 13th touchdown pass this year. Now can Baylor answer the call? They did not have good field position, their first possession. Lamar and Baker set. And it's going to be a very short kick at the 30-yard line. Keeping it away from Baker, who's one of the country's best. He's second in the Big 12. Let's go back to the touchdown. How did he get so wide open?
Well, the tight end, Ryan Hill, is right here. He's going to sneak this direction. But look at the coverage right here by Trinson Hill. Remember, he's the defensive back that's playing because Dwayne Crawford is out. He's the one that drops coverage right there. One receiver goes inside. You have to be disciplined and look for somebody coming your direction. And Trinson Hill didn't do it on that play.
Once again, two wide receivers, the top and the bottom of your screen, between the sideline and the numbers. They are spread all over the field. Griffin, quick drop, he's going to run it. Trying to find something, trying to get to the outside, and finally throws it away, and it's tipped incomplete. Pass was intended, or the pressure was put on by Pierre Allen. Let's check in with Ten Robinson, College Football Central on Versus.
Well, Rob, let's pick up right where we left you in Lawrence. Todd Reesing to Desmond Briscoe. They connected for almost 300 yards last week. That ties the game. But Graham Harrell right back down the field for Texas Tech. And this will count. Eric Morris just drags a toe in. Texas Tech up 21-14. There has been one punt so far in that game, guys.
The punter for both teams probably won't litter after that.
That's one more punt than most people would expect, I think.
After the incompletion, second and 10 from the 37. Griffin just keeps it. And he has run out of bounds. That's going to be a penalty. That could be a horse collar. It could be a couple of different things. Cody Glenn is the culprit. He got a little overzealous in the first game of the year against Western Michigan. Well, he's outstanding talent, though.
Yeah.
A tackle. Number 34, the defense. 15 yards into the end of the line. First down.
That is such a tough play because Cody Glenn is coming from that outside linebacking position, and he has the quarterback. He has to show up right there, and then Griffin is trying to fight through him. But if you can, you have to stop as soon as you see feet touching that out of bounds line. doing a nice job, Cody Glenn is, of scraping, getting to the quarterback, but you have to hold up on at the very end. 15 yards that Baylor did not deserve on that play.
Well, the horse collar also came into play there. You can't bring a guy down by his shoulder pads. First and 10 from the 43 for Baylor. Best field position of the ball game. Straight ahead running, big hole. This could be six for Baylor. Jay Finley, touchdown.
Ball carry by number 32, Jay Finley.
43 yards on the scamper by Jay Finley, his fifth rushing touchdown of the year.
And Nebraska wants to get a lot of people at the line of scrimmage to take away the short passing game. The bad part is if Finley breaks contain as he does right here, there basically is no second level. Your secondary has to come up and put a hat on Finley and bring him to the ground, but that's the risk you take by getting extra people at the line of scrimmage.
And the extra point is good. Last year, Baylor had only five rushing touchdowns. This year, that is number 17. And we are tied in Lincoln. They're going to look at the tape tomorrow or maybe even tonight and see the missed tackles on the Jay Finley touchdown run. But it does tie the score up at 7:03 left to play in the opening quarter. Paul and Alfonso Denard set to receive the kick. And Mark short on his first kickoff attempt. 85,104 in attendance today. Seventh largest crowd in Nebraska history. And they are stunned right now. Short kick at the 9-yard line. Denard breaks one tackle up over the 25 to the 26-yard line. Jake Lamar on the stop. On any given Saturday, anything can happen. Coming up next, it's an Ivy League showdown as Dartmouth takes on Columbia. Then on November 15th, in one of the most stunning upsets in college football history, the Stanford Cardinal took down the best team in the nation, the Trojans of USC. Now the long-awaited rematch. USC Stanford, Saturday, November 15th versus college football. It's wild out here. And it's wild in Lincoln, Nebraska. That's exactly what happened last week against Iowa State when Iowa State gashed them their first possession of the second half. A long run. Castile gets up over the 30 to the 31-yard line. Let's go back to that touchdown, Kelly.
Well, Baylor likes to run the zone read, and that is a give because the there's nobody taking the running back, but you could see Cody Glenn, 34, is the linebacker that has running back responsibility. Carl Pelini told us they're going to change who has that responsibility to try to confuse Robert Griffin, whether he keeps it or whether he gives it. But Nebraska had the right guy in the right place. Cody Glenn just has to make the play.
Jeremy Williams showing blitz. Gans changes the play. He hasn't missed a check at the line of scrimmage in 2 weeks. Is caught, but Jordan Lake lowers the boom on Mike McNeil. We told you that Jordan Lake is a vicious tackler. He said his heroes are Jack Tatum and John Lynch.
But Jordan Lake is playing the true safety position, which frees him up a little bit, not playing as much flat-footed as he did in the past in that 4-2-5 look in Baylor, but that's what you do as a defender. You press it from the outside in, tight end catches the ball, hit him right under the chin.
Oh, I like this young man. You see the numbers on him. He's out of Memorial High School in Houston. Third down and two for the Huskers, 5:40 to play in the first. Gans on the option. Castile got the first down, cuts inside, gets up to the 40-yard line before Jeremy Williams comes up with a first hit. But another first down for the Huskers.
And once again, the speed option. And this is the game plan that's centered around Joe Gans' ability. It's just speed to the corner. Nobody takes you. Continue to press it. And then when you feel there's traffic, go ahead and pitch the ball as he does to Castile on that play. But it gives Nebraska another way to get outside quickly, and it's been very effective.
You know, we talked to Sean Young, watching the offensive coordinator yesterday. He loves that speed option. It takes him back to his days in Colorado when he was an assistant with Gary Barnett.
And rest assured, Barney Cotton, the offensive line coach here, just thinks he's in heaven when they run that play.
And Gans going deep, trying to cut back and make the reception. Mentally, Holt could not come up with it. Lewis, the Baylor defense a little undermanned today, but so far so good.
Yeah, listen, their defensive coordinator Brian Norwood has his hands full down here on the sideline. You know, their senior cornerback Dwayne Crawford is injured. He's got the bad ankle. He's down here in street clothes trying to help out. But we saw on Nebraska's first touchdown, Princeton Hill, who was really out of position. He's a freshman, but that's what they're up against here. Got a lot of young players in that secondary right now being tested by this Nebraska offense.
Brian Norwood left Penn State after 9 years as the DB coach. His son actually is a wide receiver for the Nittany Lions. His son Jordan. Quick look in pass, caught close to the 50-yard line.
Pass complete to number 18, Menelik Holt.
About seven on the play. Menelik Holt on the reception.
Knocked up the play number three.
Yeah, we go back to that Baylor defense, and it was tough for Brian Norwood and the entire defensive staff because when they took over, they couldn't spend a whole lot of time teaching schemes back early on in spring practice. They just had to find out who they had to play defense.
Oh, yeah, and what their approach in spring and really through summer practice as well. Teach the fundamentals and then try to find out what skill set your guys have on that side of the ball so we can decide where we're going to put people.
Evaluating personnel is what they were doing. Third down and a couple. Gans rolling out, showing some patience off the fingertips of Nate Swift. That's usually a sure thing.
Yeah, those are the little things that Nebraska's going to have to do well today. I don't think Baylor's going to go away. This isn't a doormat type of team anymore. Art Briles brings enough offensively where they're going to have a puncher's chance today. If Nebraska doesn't do little things like that well, converting on third down when you have a catchable ball, you have an open receiver, Gans has to put it on him. Those things have to flow.
Van Titchener is back to kick it away. His first one went 37 yards, kicking into a breeze of about 9 to 10 miles an hour. This is a low wobbly kick, could be returned, but Baylor gets away from it. They get another good bounce. And for the second time, it'll be inside the 10, inside the 5, down to the 4-yard line. That was Jack West that kicked it. So they're alternating kicking. Oh, no, that was Tischer. And we take a look at the Big 12 North. You know, of course, Kansas playing Texas Tech today. Kelly, there's so many different scenarios here, but the bottom line is, this thing is not going to be settled for a couple of weeks.
Yeah, I think this thing is wide open, and that's why Nebraska has hope. I think Bo Pelini thinks that his team not only is getting better, but he's getting better at a time of the year where they're still in the hunt in the Big 12 North. They still have an opportunity to do something that many before this year didn't think they would.
A lot of things have to happen, but I think Bo is pleased with the position they are in right now. The officials going over to the side and talking to Bo Pelini about something.
I guarantee you that after the Missouri game, people thought that Nebraska's season basically was over with.
Yeah, I think so.
But that was a great turning point in this program, and after three losses, Bo Pelini thinks his team has gotten stronger.
Well, again, Robert Griffin backed up inside the 10. He's back on the 4-yard line for the second time in this game. And he's going to keep it. Looks for the seam, and he finds it. Over the 15, over the 20, still down the sideline, and he is shoved out of bounds, and that was close to a personal foul. And some of the Baylor players, J.D. Walton, the big center, took offense to that. That was awfully close, though, Kelly. He was teetering on the sideline.
Remember, once again, watch Cody Glenn, number 34. He gets caught up in the line of scrimmage. You cannot do that when you have Robert Griffin that has the ability to bounce it outside and make a big play. Cody Glenn is the guy that has to mirror the quarterback and be there to meet him at the line of scrimmage. You can't get caught up inside in traffic.
40-yard gain for the freshman out of Copper's Cove, Texas. And I think he doesn't like what he sees. You know, we talk about the speed of this young man who graduated from high school last December because he wanted to also run track, and he's pretty good at it. Right, Lewis?
He is awesome. You just saw what he can do on the football field. Let us show you what he can do on the track. Let's go back to the Big 12 championships this year. There's Griffin in the lead in the white uniform in the 400-meter hurdle final. Griffin winning his first Big 12 outdoor championship. He went on to finish third in the NCAA championship and actually ran in the U.S. Olympic trials. His best time, guys, is 49.22, which he ran in that race just saw, that would put him just outside the top 20 in the world. And I'm going to tell you something. If this guy concentrated on track, which I know won't happen, he could be a guy contending for the Olympic team. But he is a bad boy when it comes to running. Speed.
We got to say, though, Lewis, we were talking to Art Briles on Wednesday. One of the first things he said is, hey, Lewis, you still running? I want to know if you can run as fast as that guy. You were an 800 guy, though.
And the answer is absolutely not. Let's just keep it real. That's not going to happen.
Yeah, let alone get over those hurdles when you are running, right, Lou?
That's exactly right. It's all about speed and step pattern. The 400 hurdles considered one of the most difficult races in track and field.
And he does it well. Now he's got three wide receivers to the right on first and 10 from the 44-yard line. Griffin, three rushes, 49 yards today. Straight ahead, not much going on there. Maybe able to pick up a couple on the play. Ndamukong Suh underneath the pile.
Ron, you talked about how wide the wide receivers are for Baylor. They're split outside the numbers, which really presses the defense because the nickel defender that's in the game, he really can't figure into the running game. Look how wide they are out here. So this defender has a hard time staying outside to be in pass coverage, but also stick his nose in to be a run defender as well.
Well, on second down and 7. Griffin just ducks his head, maybe picked up a couple. That'll set up a third down and 4. Baylor moving players all over the place. Brad Taylor's checked in the lineup, and he'll go wide to the right. I mean, wide to the right.
And Baylor runs what Briles calls an altered tempo offense. A lot of times Griffin will go to the line of scrimmage, but then he steps back, and Art Briles literally calls the play from the sideline.
Third down, Griffin's pass caught at the 47-yard line. It's complete. It'll be just a little bit short of the first down.
Well, here
Thomas
you go.
White on the reception.
How about a decision right here? Once again, you're looking for yards after the catch on a play like this. Griffin, very organized, very deliberate, puts the ball where he needs to.
And on fourth down, Griffin keeps it and he breaks it. Inside the 10, tripped up. Did he get in? Touchdown, Baylor. He's got a 40-yarder, a 47-yarder. That is 6.
Bob, you can see when he gets to the edge, it's going to be an event for Nebraska to catch up with him. But also, Baylor caught Nebraska off guard with that hurry up. It wasn't a decision by Art Briles. Create some momentum and then try to maintain it in this football game.
Two touchdowns given up by Nebraska, both on long runs, 43 and 47, as the extra point is good. And the Baylor Bears have taken the lead 14-7.
And a lot of times quarterback sneaks obviously go up inside, and it caught Nebraska's defensive front off a little bit because Griffin just bounces it outside, and then he has obviously the athletic ability to make a big play out of it.
One of the things that Carl Pelini has really stressed, and Bo Pelini, is that this team, how they finish the season, goes with how they stick to the scheme. Carl Pelini says, when you're playing a Griffin, you can't get too fancy schmancy on this thing. You've got to play your scheme. With that in mind, what happened?
Yeah, and what Bo talked about, Bo Pelini told us that Nebraska's players are still learning how to focus on the minute details of playing this game, and you can see it right there. I didn't see who the defender was, but quarterback sneak, he's thinking, I'm just going to go over the top inside because that's where the quarterback is. And guess what? Griffin bounces his outside, and nobody is there to contain the young quarterback.
And the crowd of 84,000 plus stunned Baylor fans like what they see. They're trying to even up their record this year. And of course, snap that losing skid in the Big 12 on the road.
And Ron, what Baylor needs to do is also maintain the momentum that they've created. That's a difficult thing for a young team.
From the 5-yard line, Niles Paul tripped up at the 17-yard line. Every ride is critical and every second is tough, and it all comes down to this. The PBR World Finals, the best Cowboys and the rankest Bulls square off in the PBR event of the year. $1 million purse and the cherished golden buckle are on the line. The PBR World Finals live from Las Vegas start October 31st only on Versus. Mentally, Colt is down for Nebraska, and he gets up with a little hitch. Follow up. And that would be a major loss because the coach is saying that now they had four solid receivers. When you look at Peterson, Paul, Holt, and Swift, and yeah, they like what Holt has done, it's kind of opened up Swift's game.
It really has, because Holt can jump out and play that X receiver on the outside, and then Swift can go inside. And Sean Watson right now is in good rhythm with this offense, using a lot of different personnel groupings. So that receiver right there and Holt is a viable part of what Nebraska intends to do today.
Nebraska's defense gave up 218 yards the entire game last week versus Iowa State. In the first quarter today, Baylor's got 148. But the Huskers have the football, trailing by a touchdown, inside of 2:25 to play in the first. Roy Heller is checked into the backfield. Play action, Gans dumps it off to Mike McNeil up over the 20-yard line. They'll mark him out at the 22.5. Jordan Lake already 7 tackles today from that free safety spot. Brings up a 2nd and 4, so they stay ahead of the chains.
Right now, what Nebraska needs to do to try to take that momentum away from Baylor is go on one of their patented long drives. They've possessed the ball a long time this year. They need to do it right here.
They had 40 minutes against Texas Tech, 37 minutes against Iowa State last week. Gans, the quick pass. That'll be close to the first down. Nate Swift, his 4th catch of the day. He needed 7 to tie Johnny Rogers all time. 3 away from that historic mark, and Johnny Rogers is in attendance today. You know, it's, you look at what he did his freshman year with 45 receptions, an incredible freshman year, set the record here. He's had an outstanding career, but Johnny Rogers said, don't forget, I played one less year than him.
Johnny reminded you of that, huh?
Yeah. 3rd down and less than 1 for Nebraska from the eye. There's Johnny Rogers' number up there. And what a great 71 Nebraska OU game he had. Castile, the thumper. He's got the first down, and Jordan Lake's not afraid to meet him.
Yeah.
Castile at 235, Lake at 210.
The thumper in red meets the thumper in on Baylor's side of the field right there. Jordan Lake is not afraid to bring the wood from that safety position. He loves to play downhill.
Fresh set of downs for Nebraska inside of a minute here in quarter number 1, and it has been an exciting one. The pitch back to Helu. Tries to get a block, cuts back inside, and he makes something out of nothing. Gets up close to the 34-yard line, and Taurus Bryant on the stop.
That's a good job by Nebraska, using the motion by the young tight end number 49 Young that time, gets outside. And Sean Watson said an interesting thing yesterday. They try to find ways to play outside of the defense. That's a great example, which basically means out leverage them, get more at the point of attack than the defense can bring out there.
And he continues to roll in 3 I backs with Lucky, Hello, and Castile. Gans, look out, and he is going to go down. Gans will be sacked for the 12th time this year, the 14th sack for that Baylor defense. Earl Patan with his first sack, and that's the way the first quarter is going to end up. So the Baylor Bears shaking their head. Yes, they like what they see so far. A couple of long runs, a touchdown by Finley, a touchdown by Griffin. And the Nebraska Cornhuskers trail at the end of 1, 14-7. Nebraska begins the second quarter, 3rd down and 11, ball back on the 29-yard line. They're 3 of 5 on 3rd down already this afternoon. Helu is in the backfield. Baylor showing blitz, and here they come. Nebraska picks it up, going deep, pass is incomplete, intended for Nate Swift. Overthrown by Gans.
Ron, you talked about the blitz right there. Defensive coordinator Brian Norwood said that Baylor said that they would want to bring pressure, but the key is getting Nebraska into a sure throwing down. It's hard to gauge when Nebraska is going to throw the football because Sean Watson is so impeccably balanced that it's hard to get a gauge when you want to bring that blitz.
And now Nebraska is going to have to kick it away again. Dan Titchener, who's been able to do a pretty good job so far, a little more consistency. Joe Bennett back for Baylor, and this is going to be a low spiraling kick. Bennett looks up in the sun. Did it hit a Baylor player? Did it hit a Baylor player? Nebraska finally covers it up, and I think it might be their football. The officials are going to have to talk about it. It looked like it hit a Baylor player. Not sure. No, they're saying it's Baylor's football. Boy, that was close. Bennett was looking up in the sun, Kelly.
Yeah, Bennett really didn't have an idea where that ball was going until the last minute.
But right there, the ball hit a member of the kicking team. The ball will be placed at the spot of first touch.
It looked like Brian, number three.
But did it hit Nebraska first? It's down when it did.
I don't think so. I think it hit Brian right in the foot.
I think it did too. The officials are going to have to look at it on the replay.
And Nebraska did get the ball at the end of this play. Look at number three, Brian. The foot that comes down right at the end. I think that punt hits his foot.
I am surprised that everybody was kind of standing around. We only had two players heads up enough to try to recover it. Why take the chance?
Actually, it looks like the left foot.
Yeah.
Of Brian hit that football. I think the field judge to this side didn't call anything. He let the play go, which is not a bad choice. Don't blow the whistle early if you have a question about it.
This is the best angle. Watch the football right there.
Absolutely. I think you can see the football somewhat redirected. And Brian may not be going after it because he doesn't want the word out that it hit his foot. A lot of times they'll play coy like that.
Well, Nebraska was also kind of standing around on that. Well, they're going to have to take a look at it. Rick Lumiere, our referee, up talking to the guys in the replay booth.
And always remember,
replay official.
Always remember, Ron, and if you're home watching the game, when it's under review, keep in mind how it was called on the field originally, because a lot of times they don't have conclusive video evidence, and so they don't overturn anything. It isn't that they don't have a question. They just don't have anything that proves that it should be overturned.
Let's take one more look. This is what they're looking at upstairs, a couple of booths down from us. See how the ball kind of died?
That ball was headed across both of the players, Brian from Nebraska, or number 21 from Nebraska, and also Brian, number 3 from Baylor.
Now they're going to have to take a long, hard look at this because this is tough as Popolini waits, Brian waits. And Brian's probably got his fingers crossed right about now. Kelly going, oh, please, oh, please, oh, please.
Remember the little games within the game. Art Briles know that his team on the road especially needs momentum, which they got by that touchdown, a couple of long rushing touchdowns by Finley and then by Griffin.
As we look at Art Briles, he's got to be pretty pleased so far with his team's effort because they've got nearly 150 yards already, courtesy, of course, of a couple of long runs. But this would just kind of puts a sour taste in your mouth if it goes against him. Well, I don't think it hits Nebraska until right. I don't even know if it does there. That's tough to see. Because if it hits the kicking team, the ball is down right there.
Amua Kimura was the number 21 for Nebraska, and you couldn't see that it hit his foot.
Here we go.
The ruling on the field stands as called. The ball will be placed at the spot of first touch in 24-yard line, first down.
Not conclusive, I think, is what they probably decided. Well, Bo Pelini goes, wait a minute. Hey, are you sure about that? And Art Briles goes, let's just get out there and play. Come on.
Yeah, go get a snap.
Yeah, go get
but
a
if
snap.
If you're Art Briles, you have the momentum right now, and a play like that can erase it in a heartbeat. And right now, that's obviously a great development if you're a Baylor Bear fan.
And now Bo's walking out on the field. I don't know if he's going to challenge it again.
Well, they want to know where the football is.
Yeah, well, the football should be
back. If it didn't hit anybody,
back.
The no, football should be back around the 5-yard line.
They're saying it must have hit a Nebraska player. That's why they're placing the football there. And I don't think that was conclusive.
No, I don't believe that's right.
Oh, my.
I don't think it hit a Nebraska player. That wasn't even in question.
Well, if it wasn't conclusive on the fumble, how could it be conclusive on this? Baylor goes back to work with their ground game. Well, it was ruled first touch by Nebraska at that spot. We've got a Baylor player down.
Number 75, Jordan Hervey, is the left guard that's down. And remember, right now, Baylor's strength is up front on the line of scrimmage offensively. A veteran group that has done a nice job thus far on the year.
Jordan Hervey out of Richardson, Texas, a junior. He's one of the many recipients of an Art Briles nickname. He's nicknamed a lot of the players that call him Swerve. Oh, we've got a moment here in Lincoln, Nebraska. Let's check in with Ted Robinson in our studios in Connecticut.
Well, Ron, Texas Tech is putting on another show. Five possessions, five touchdowns. Graham Harrell to Eric Morris. Harrell is 22 of 24 for 247 and four touchdowns in the first half. You've heard that before, Ron.
I tell you, yeah. That's a machine there. And you know what? There's some similarities between Coach Briles, who was the running backs coach with Mike Leach at Texas Tech, as Hervey limps off the field, and this Baylor offense, because neither one really has a playbook, Kelly.
Yeah, which is kind of strange. You watch Art Briles on the sideline. He doesn't have a call sheet on game day either. He calls his play from just a feel, kind of a gut feel, each and every play throughout the game.
Second down six, and that last call on the punt has got the crowd riled up. Chris Griesenbeck, the junior out of Lee High School in San Antonio, has checked in. Pass complete, and the wood is lowered, but not before the reception by Justin Fenty, the junior out of Denton, Texas. What a hit, though.
The play action is just to draw the linebackers in so you can get that ball over the top. Asante does a nice job of reacting, but a little too late.
And that's a first down for the Baylor Bears, who are not allowing this crowd to get to them, especially the freshman quarterback. Pickup of 13 on the play, first and 10. Asante sneaks up into the line of scrimmage, misses the tackle. And that allows Baylor to pick up five, possibly six, maybe even 7 yards. Asante was sneaking up from that strong safety spot, Kelly, but he just flat out missed.
When he was in the right place, he just needs to come under control and make a tackle. Both Carl and Bo Pelini told us that they have to make the play when they're there to make it.
Penalty flag is thrown as it's a quick snap.
And I think the quick snap didn't allow his own players to get set on that play.
Well, you still have to allow the defense to get set, too. And they're talking to Nebraska, so obviously it's against Baylor. And both
wide out. Illegal motion. The offensive line was not set. 5-yard penalty against the offense. Replay second down.
Well, that'll bring up a second down and 9.
Another interesting point about Art Briles' offense, Ron, is that there really aren't any tendencies that come down in distance.
Right.
As defensive teams study Baylor, it looks the same regardless if it's third and long or first and 10.
You saw the rushing yards last week against Oklahoma State. Baylor had only 42 yards rushing. Second down and 9 from the 42. Straight ahead, nothing doing as Finley has stood up. Maybe a pickup of a yard on the play. Ndamukong Suh on the stop. Also, a little Dillard from that middle linebacker spot. That brings up a third down and 8.
And Ron, this is normally where Nebraska would want to bring pressure, but they don't want to go man-to-man and leave a lot of green grass for the young quarterback to get loose. So look forward to rush more aware and under control, but not play man-to-man behind it.
And Bo Pelini called a timeout, and Carl Pelini had to run out. He was talking to the official. Now Bo is giving the head linesman also a little pep talk. Baylor facing third down and 8, balls on their own 43-yard line. Bo got his say into the officials. Robert Griffin looks around, checking the Nebraska defense. Here comes the blitz. Griffin's got time. steps away, takes a second hit, and he's going down back at the 30-yard line. Prince Amukamara coming in from that quarterback spot. His first sack of the year.
Amukamara doing a nice job of staying outside and being aware of where Griffin is going. This is what Carl Pelini wants to do, is rush under control, a little bit more awareness, and don't let the quarterback have an escape route, in a sense, open the door.
What we saw, too, is Ndamukong Suh putting the pressure on, which really made that play. Fair catch is called for. That almost should have been a flag because he wasn't given a real good opportunity. Looks like he got hit as he was throwing up his arm. Kick of 35 yards, and that's where Nebraska will take over. Capital of Nebraska is Lincoln, Nebraska, and they also have the licorice place at the Haymarket and a couple of great places to eat, underlining great, including the ice cream. That is the one that Kelly had, actually. The one
No, I did not. I had the lemon custard, I believe.
With his family, and they have contributed to the economy of Lincoln, Nebraska.
We've seen it all, let me tell you that.
Now Nebraska first and 10 from their own 33-yard line. Trailing 14-7. His run game gets going up over the 40 to the 41-yard line. Marlon Lucky, senior out of North Hollywood, California, only one 100-yard rushing game this year. That came against New Mexico State, but he had a great game against Iowa State. Two touchdowns in that contest. They want to use him, Kelly, where he could be successful. You know, last year he had 75 catches, but they're kind of using him in different ways now. On second down and short. Gans keeps it, has the first down. Up over the 45 to the 46-yard line. Jordan Lake, 11 tackles already in this ballgame. One of the things we were talking about a lot, Kelly, and you were interested in, is just the balance and where the ball is going for Nebraska.
Nebraska not only wants to be balanced run and pass, but they also want to be balanced in where they attack. You can see right now they're attacking short, but look for this to grow as the day goes along. Sean Watson wants to attack 52 yards wide. He wants to get sideline to sideline, but also vertically, and make defenses defend the entire field.
He said he's driven by balance. Little high snap, Gans brings it down. Lucky tries to get away from an onslaught of Bear defenders led by Antonio Jones. And he's going to lose a yard on the play.
You know, right now, Ron, I think Baylor defensively is playing with a lot of confidence. Mm-hmm. They like playing a lot of guys at the line of scrimmage, loading the box, and then just trying to transition to coverage. Right now, I think Nebraska needs to force the issue down the field a little bit, like we just saw in that graphic. Everything has been under 10 yards. They got to expand it vertically right now.
We'll see, because they're facing second down and 12. Gans from under center. McNeil goes in motion. The quick pass. Caught up over the 50-yard line and driven back is Nate Swift.
Ron, you talked about McNeil was the tight end that's in motion, and instead of stopping at the end of the line of scrimmage, he continues out wide and actually becomes the lead blocker for Nate Swift. On that screen, it's a nice little screen package that Nebraska has, but primarily Nate Swift is the target.
And it's third down and about 5 to go. Picked up 7 on the play. Swift with 5 receptions already here in the first half. Had 8 in the first half last week. 3 away from Johnny Rogers. Gans. Pass caught. McNeil. First down, Nebraska. Inside the 45, down to the 43-yard line.
This is what Gans is doing so well and manages the game. McNeil just goes inside, sits down right in the middle. That's number one. If you see the numbers pointing to you and you need a first down, that's your maintenance pass right there. Get him the football, move the chains.
He's got the luxury of having some outstanding tight ends with McNeil, Young, and of course Ryan Hill today with a touchdown. Two running backs, Castile and Lucky. Gans fakes the pitch to Castile, and he is stood up. Joe Pavelic, the junior out of Smithson Valley High School in Spring Branch, Texas. Lewis, you got an injury update for us.
And at Nebraska sideline, Holt, their wide receiver number 18, came off earlier with a problem with the right knee. and looked at him a long time, put some ice on it, and the look on his face says that he's done for the day. And then on the near side here behind the Baylor bench, Jordan Hervey, the big man, the left guard, came off. A lot of time looked at his left knee, and then he's got the ice on, and of course he's been getting a lot of pats on the back, which says to me that he's probably done as well.
All right, good job, Lewis, keeping us posted on that. Second down and 10 from the 43 for Nebraska. Gibbs pass complete to Todd Peterson. Down to the 30-yard line, another Nebraska first down, their ninth of the ball game.
Ron, we talked about the difference in formationing and then just using different personnel. Peterson is outside. He's just going to run a hook route with Nate Swift hooked already inside of him, holding that coverage and opening up that window for Todd Peterson.
At least three receptions every game this year for Peterson. That was his first for this afternoon. And Nebraska, we talked, Kelly, you mentioned a few moments ago, they needed one of those sustained drives. They're getting it now. Yes, fakes the option. Looking deep. Has a man tripped up? Is there a flag? No. The officials both looked at it. It was intended for Peterson. Chris Burke, the sophomore quarterback out of Mesquite, Texas, on the coverage.
I think this is a great no call. Remember the speed option Nebraska ran a couple of times. This is the play action off of it. Gans started down the line of scrimmage, pulls back and wants Peterson deep. I think that's a good no call. I don't think either one of them had an opportunity for that football.
I like seeing that, but they don't make that call. Peterson being met by Coach Gilmore, Ted Gilmore, the wide receivers coach, as he goes off. Second down and 10 from the 30 for the Huskers. Gans looks left side, passes complete. Ball is loose. It goes out of bounds. Let's see what the officials say. Here we say, we can hear him saying out of bounds, out of bounds. Drew Young had the football, lost it, and it was teetering on the sideline.
The field judge does a nice job of running down the sideline and calling this out of bounds. Young needs to hang on to that football. But right there, teetering right on the line, I think that's a good call. The field judge from the end zone comes running down, had the best angle of it, this guy up here, and sees it touch right there.
Yeah, great call.
And officials make the right call most of the time when they're in position, and that's a good example of it.
Well, it brings up a third down and 6. Gans buying some time, using his legs. First down, Nebraska. Inside the 20, down to about the 14-yard line is Niles Paul. His second reception of the afternoon.
Once again, Nebraska choosing to move Gans out of the pocket, and Niles is just going to sit down where? At first down depth. Show your numbers to the quarterback. He actually stepped out of bounds. That should have been an illegal touch by that wide receiver. He wasn't forced out. Great camera work right there. Officials miss one. Nebraska doesn't mind it, though.
Baylor's not asking for a review. I'm not even sure if that's reviewable. Gans, the quick pass outlet. Inside the 15-yard line, a mark it down at the 10-yard line for Nate Swift. Another catch. He's got 6 already. One away from tying Johnny Rogers' all-time mark of 143 receptions.
And that little play doesn't look like much, but it's the yards after the catch. It's just like an extension of the run game for Nebraska, and Swift does it incredibly well. That big, long body, he gets a lot of yards after he touches it.
Now Chris Brooks goes wide to the right. Second down and 4 from the 10. Going to run the option back to Lucky. He is met right at the line of scrimmage and upended. Going underneath him is Antonio Johnson, the sophomore out of Waco. He's a guy that was playing defensive end in the spring. Talk told you about one away now from Johnny Rogers. He also came into the game just 458 yards receiving yards away from Johnny Rogers, and he has a good chance of also catching that. You see Marlon Lucky, everybody thought he would be the first one to break Johnny Rogers' mark, because at the start of the season he was closer than Swift. Third down and 4 from the 10. 13th play of this drive. Let it roll, let it roll. Gans has some time, throws behind the intended receiver, Niles Paul, Antonio Jones on the coverage. Not a good pass, though.
And a good job by Baylor actually showing blitz getting out of the blitz and actually only rushed the down four linemen. There were a lot of guys to work through. Paul was coming underneath that coverage and the ball was behind him.
Alex Henry, who's only missed two field goals in 2 years, 16 of 18 career. He's lining this one up. It'll be a 27-yarder. The holder, Jake Wesch. Good snap. Ball is down. Did it sneak inside? It did. So Henry, who had four field goals from 44 yards versus Western Michigan, gets his first today, and Nebraska within four.
Baylor 14, Nebraska 10.
14-play drive for Nebraska. It covered better than 6 minutes, and they had to settle for a field goal, 14-10. We've got 5:41 left in the first half. Is that disappointing for Nebraska, Kelly?
I really think it is, but I don't think it's all that bad, because what they needed to do is have an extended drive and try to take some of the momentum away from Baylor, and I think they were successful. But now the defense has to follow up right here, get a three and out, give it back to your offense, and continue on.
Baker and Lamar set to receive the kick. Bo Pelini's defense has given up 161 yards today in the opening half, but about 143 of those came in the opening quarter. So they've done better in quarter number two. And again, the ball slips off. Adi Kanalik is the kicker for Nebraska. He has become a crowd favorite. Fans chant his name. They hold up shoes in the end zone because he's able to put balls into the end zone. A native of Bosnia, high school, North Crowley High School in Fort Worth. Got a big leg. And this is going to drive back to the 2-yard line. Fumbled by Baker. He's trying to bring it out. And he is stood up at the 7, driven back to the 2. Matt Holt on the tackle. And again, for the third time in this ballgame, Baylor is going to be backed up inside the 10-yard line. Along with Kelly Stoffer, I'm Rod Doolin. Right now, I think if you're Baylor, you look at the fact that you moved the ball, you gashed them for a couple of big runs, you're probably feeling pretty good about yourself.
I think you are, but you have to finish the half strong right now. I think Nebraska's, their last drive gave them the momentum back just a little bit. Griffin has to do something right here to try to take that momentum into halftime.
Now remember, the last time they were backed up inside the 10-yard line, Griffin broke a long run. He keeps it again, and again he gets a first down, and he is hogtied at about the 19-yard line. Boy, Griffin is able to get out of a hole so quickly. That's Eric Hag on the stop.
Those long legs. I mean, he chews up ground right very quickly, but that's the second part of that zone read. You cannot let Robert Griffin beat you today. Make him give that football every time if you're in Nebraska's defense.
And he is their leading rusher today. 7 carries, 100 yards already for Griffin. They just continue to run the ball, running it on the right side. The Nebraska defense right there to meet Kendall Wright coming from that inside receiver spot. There's Carl Pelini.
And I think if you're Carl Pelini, Ron, I think you have to force your defensive scheme to give Robert Griffin a give read every time he runs that read zone option. Make him give the football up.
2nd down and 7, closing in on 4.5 to play in the first half. Griffin doesn't do a whole lot of checking at the line, but he does it there. Looks left. Streaking down the sideline, overthrown. Pass was intended for Ernest Smith. Let's check in with Lewis Johnson. Lewis, we have a little substitute official, huh?
Absolutely. Hugh Douglas, who's working the near side now with the clipboard, started the game as the umpire, but he told me a few moments ago that he suffered a bone spur under his right kneecap when he was reffing a game in Kansas last week. He started the game but didn't feel right and said, you know what, I got to do this for my team and for the betterment of the game. So he pulled himself out. Jim Adams is now the umpire, and Buddy Jean-Gras is the side judge. And you guys have already talked about the job they've been doing. Quick adjustments for the officials.
And they're very, very good at that. 3rd down and 7 from the 23. Baylor 0 for 3 in this situation today. Penalty flag. And it's going to be against Baylor.
Prior to the snap, false start, 17 of the offense. 5-yard penalty remains 3rd down.
John David Weed, the culprit.
run. It goes from third and 7 to third and 12, but that doesn't necessarily change Art Briles's play calling.
Exactly.
As Carl Pliny told us yesterday, as they studied this offense, down and distance means nothing to Art Briles.
There's a good look at Coach Briles, a coaching icon in the Texas High School Coaches Association at Georgetown and Stephenville High School.
And once again, look at the splits out here, how wide the wide receivers are. It's hard for this guy to be part of the running game.
Two to snap it. Griffin looking left, and he is going to be buried at the 10-yard line. Pierre Allen with a sack, his second of the year.
Well, it looked to me like Baylor had slide protection up front on the line of scrimmage to the left. And you don't leave Allen, the defensive end, unblocked. The young quarterback was not aware of it, but I think that's on his offensive line.
He's subbing for Barry Turner, who was hurt early in the season. And Allen last week played with a heavy heart as his sister passed away just over a week and a half ago. And this is a bad kick. Oh, my.
Well, Ron, we talked about momentum that Baylor had a little bit of. It just flew out the window and landed on Nebraska's side without a doubt.
Momentum doesn't choose favorites, does it?
No, it certainly doesn't. But, man, does it have an effect on a football game.
Tuesdays and Thursdays versus is stirring the soup with the new original series, Sports Soup, hosted by comedian Matt Eisman. Featuring the week's best highlights, lowlights, and everything in between. We're covering the coverage with the hilarious show that sports writes. Sports Soup, all new every Tuesdays and Thursdays in 10, right here on Versus.
And our goal is to not be on that show, Ron, all right? We're not part of the blooper package.
No.
Sports Soup.
I don't know. Maybe we get Larry the Cable Guy. He's here today. Maybe we get him on the show. First and 10 for Nebraska. Great field position. Baylor 36-yard line. Lucky dances around down to the 30-yard line before Joe Pavelic makes the stop, his second tackle of the ball game. Pavelic with 84 tackles already this year. He's a tackling machine in the middle. Been playing since he was a freshman. And you can see the rushing and pass yards for Nebraska. And we're talking about keeping things even and balanced.
Yeah, they are that. They just need to finish a drive right here. And you can tell when Nebraska needs a running play, they're very right-handed behind Slauson and Murtha like they were on that play to Lucky.
Gans has time. Rolling out. Looking, looking. Decides to keep it. Scampers out of bounds inside the 30. And it's going to be very close to a first down. Stay tuned for the Nissan Heisman Watch coming up at halftime on Versus.
There's a lot of things in college football that is wide open, and I think the Heisman is one of those things. I think,
yeah,
Colt McCoy right now is my leader in the,
absolutely,
at this point in time of the year, but I'm not sure he can maintain that incredible pace that he's playing at.
We'll find out today against Oklahoma State.
Huge down right here for Nebraska, Ron.
Third down and 3. Gans will look to pass. Has a man in the flat. One-handed catch by Lucky. What a reception by Marlon Lucky. His first of the ball game. 18th of the year, picks up 11.
I love it when receivers bail the quarterback out. Gans kind of sails this in a little bit, but look at the catch right there. Stick that big left hand out, catch the football. And Ron, you're taught as a quarterback, especially with running backs and tight ends, you have to throw it into their body, but not with Lucky. He has impeccable, great hands as a receiver out of the backfield.
Once again, he led the nation as far as running backs receiving last year with 75.
Head on, head on.
Lucky right up the middle, looking for Pater. Touchdown, Nebraska. That was the Marlon Lucky Show.
Wow. Two plays back to back. The great catch, and why not reward Marlon Lucky and let him take the ball into the end zone? The senior out of the backfield picks his team up.
That was impressive. And Henry trying to stay perfect with extra points. And he is.
Marlon Lucky is best out in space, and this is a good example of it. Run up inside. Red Nation, Husker Nation has something to cheer about.
the touchdown, his seventh rushing touchdown, eighth overall on the year, and that's given Nebraska the lead at 17-14, along with Lewis Johnson, Kelly Stoffer. Ron Thulin welcoming you back to Lincoln, Nebraska, as we continue college football right here on Versus. And a crowd of 84,000 now on its feet. And they were questioning what was going on a few minutes ago. We told you about Kanalik's leg. We saw it there. Let's check in with Ted Robinson. Ted, what do you got coming up at halftime?
Well, Ron, Roland Williams will join me for the Craftsman Halftime Report. It is all offense. Big 12 shootouts galore with Texas Tech, Kansas, and OU in Kansas State. We'll have scores and highlights of those, as well as our Nissan Heisman watch, and a little closer look at how the new BCS standings affect the Big 12. Ron?
And Ron, you thought Oklahoma might have a hard time with Kansas State today. You might be right on that one, brother.
You know, you look at Kansas State's history, they always have that one game where you go, did they really win that game? They did it at Texas a few years ago. And now Baylor takes over. They've got 2 minutes and 6 seconds to work with. Griffin, the quick look in, caught up over the 25 to the 28-yard line. This freshman has shown so much poise today. He's done a great job running the football. 8 rushes, 93 yards, and a touchdown. He's broken a couple of long ones. They call, or Blouse calls him Cream because he rises to the top. Jay Finley gets the first down, stops the clock with 1:38 left in the half.
This is a tough place for Art Briles' offense. With the young quarterback, everything is so orchestrated and defined for him. They don't take a lot of chances, but in two-minute offense, the hurry-up mode, you can't really help it. You're going to have to open it up a little bit.
Now they're substituting. Baylor still bringing players on, and they're going to have to let the defense at least adjust to that. And the official does the wise thing and says, okay, they brought somebody in. The defense can make an adjustment.
A good example of it. All the while, the clock continues to run.
Griffin looking down the middle. Got a man looking for Kendall Wright. Had it, dropped it. Oh, my goodness. We saw Geddes drop a ball last week versus Oklahoma State that should have been 6. Wright drops this one, could have been 6.
Nebraska didn't look like they were set in the secondary. We saw the people running off the field and on the field. I don't think Nebraska was straight in coverage that point in time, but you're right. We talked about taking advantage of the opportunities, making plays. There's a huge one that drops by the wayside right there.
2 weeks in a row now for this Baylor offense. 63 seconds left in the half. Griffin looking to run, and he is going to be dropped, and it may be a face mask penalty, I'm not sure, or a hold. He's thrown back at the 20-yard line. The flags came in from everywhere. I'm not sure where the hands were by Cody Glenn on
Cody
that.
Cody Glenn is getting called for it, but I'm not so sure he wasn't underneath the face mask on the collar, so it could be the collar
horse
penalty,
collar.
The horse collar penalty, but they usually don't call that if the quarterback is in the pocket, so it's
personal where
he was.
Face mask, 15-yard penalty from the previous spot.
Yeah.
Second personal foul on Cody Glenn today.
And Cody Glenn just did not think that he had the face mask on that play. I think he did.
Yeah, he did. Because there's no unintentional one. You know, they got rid of that one this year, thank goodness.
The 5-yard one, the 5-yard penalty is by the wayside, so if face masking is called at all, it's 15 yards or nothing.
The first penalty on Cody Glenn got Baylor out of a big hole. This one got him out of the hole. Now Griffin keeps it, stops, lets his feet, has a man wide open, caught inside the 20, down to the 17-yard line. Ernest Smith with the reception. That's his first of the ball game.
Ernest Smith with the double move outside, and that's what Nebraska has problems with, is making adjustments and things they haven't seen a whole lot in that young secondary.
And that's what concerned Carl Pelini.
Absolutely.
Said, our scheme has got to be, you've got to trust the scheme, even though you haven't seen it, you still got to play the scheme. Griffin looks, fires, caught. Kendall Wright, is he in? Waiting for the signal from the official to say he's down to the 1-yard line. What a catch, though. Wright making up for the drop.
Kendall Wright just running the slant.
as the inside receiver, he actually crosses the football. Nebraska has to just squeeze that down. Kimball Wright does a nice job catching it, extending to the end zone. I think this is going to be reviewed.
Now, once again, there is no rule in the rule book that says a ground cannot cause a fumble. It's not in the college rule book. And a catch, they call it, it's not a moment in time, it's a process. He's got to come down with a football.
A good job by the young receiver, Kendall Wright. Remember, he's a true freshman getting the ball from another true freshman in Robert Griffin. That ball was behind him on the back shoulder. That's generally, Ron, a very tough catch to make when the slant is thrown hard to your back shoulder.
This can take us back almost to the OU Texas game where there was an interception in the end zone by Oklahoma, which would have thwarted a Texas drive.
The ruling on the field is confirmed. First down.
Good call by the officials.
In the meantime, Ron, we only have 21 seconds left, so Baylor doesn't have a great deal of time to get something done here. They do have two timeouts left.
233 yards for this Baylor offense. That's averaging 375 for the game. Baylor has called timeout. As Kelly mentioned, 21 seconds left to play in the half. On any given Saturday, anything can happen. And coming up next, it's an Ivy League showdown as Dartmouth takes on Columbia. And then a reminder, tune in November 15th, because if you remember, in one of the most stunning upsets in college football history, the Stanford Cardinal beat the best team in the nation, the Trojans of USC, last season. Now it's the long-awaited rematch. USC Stanford Saturday, November 15th versus college football. It's wild out here.
Well, Ron, we talked about the importance of momentum for both football teams, but particularly Baylor going on the road, wanting to win their first Big 12 game on the road this season, and momentum is a huge thing. But you get kind of double momentum, Ron, when you gain it going in at halftime. It means something even more.
Baylor has lost 8 straight road games in Big 12 play. They've got it first and goal on the 1-yard line. 21 seconds left. Baylor's got one timeout left. They go with a little jumbo package. Straight ahead. Touchdown, Baylor's Jacoby Jones.
Well, the combination, Jacoby Jones going into the end zone, finishes this drive off. But how about the young playmakers on this Baylor offense in this hurry-up two-minute situation at the end of the half,
and
seizing that momentum as they go into the locker room?
Especially the fact that on that drive, Griffin was 3 of 4 for 59 yards, and he set a new Baylor record of 162 passes without an interception. Ben Parks on for the extra point, and it is blocked, and it's alive. Nebraska's got it. They've got some green. Finally tripped up as the clock goes to 17 seconds. And we've got a penalty flag on the play, but still the extra point was blocked. Earlier this year, Zach Potter blocked an extra point against Texas Tech. This time it's Ndamukong Suh with a block. Let's get the call.
After the play, personal foul, number 43 of the receiving team. Defense. Penalty will be penalized 15 yards on the kickoff.
Ty Steinkuhler. Let's take a look at this block again.
And remember, Nebraska can return this for 2 points themselves. Ndamukong Suh, it actually looked like Steinkuhler got penetration as well. And then Steinkuhler, as this ball is being returned, I think gets a personal foul for hitting somebody that was not in the play.
So you got to give kudos to Ben Parks on that, the kicker, because he's the one who made the tackle. There was a lot of green left open on that.
Yeah, there was a convoy starting to form over there of Nebraska players. That could have easily been 2 points.
Nebraska calls a timeout. They've got one left. Baylor's got one left. And Bo Pelini again pleading his case. Big hits in this football game already. Watch this one. Kaboom. Jordan Lake.
Well, that's not Jordan Lake. That's Asante. But you're right. Nebraska wants to play physical football, but Baylor has done a nice job of responding to Nebraska's physical play as well.
Robert Griffin also had a comeback from a hit. He took quite a wallop. Didn't seem to bother him. Lewis, what do you think about that?
Well, I got to tell you something. That shot that Griffin took told me a lot about him being a football player and not just a track guy. When he came off the field, he got a little bit of a congratulations, but no talking to trainers. Everybody knew he was all right. And I think it's a shot like that is when you find out whether a guy is a track guy playing football or a real football player running track. That's what I saw.
That's a great point to make, because Art Briles said the same thing about David Geddes, the wide receiver, who was more of a speed guy, a track guy that didn't know how to play football. And now he's becoming a football guy that just knows how to run fast. I think Robert Griffin's a good example. The toughness that young man has shown just in this game proves that he can do both.
Those track guys are tough, though, with the exception of one I can think of.
We smacked Lewis around just a little bit to prove that, right?
You reminded me of my good buddy Ronaldo Nehemiah, Skeets. Remember him?
Yes.
Wayne Hurdler. Can remember him? Wide receiver for the 49ers, right?
Yeah.
Crossing pattern, hit, knocked out. And Skeets has told me many times that was a serious gut check moment for him about his love for the game of football. Huh?
This is the guy, though, Kelly, that gets in the car yesterday when it's 50 degrees and says, it's cold.
Yeah. Gets in the car and says, I think I pulled my hammy. That's our Lewis Johnson right there.
We love you, Lewis. Baylor kicks it away with 17 seconds left, and it's going to be a short kick again. From the 8-yard line, Niles Paul. Of course, the first BCS rankings came out this past week in the top 10. You look at the Big 12 flavor there with Texas, Oklahoma, Oklahoma State, Texas Tech. You got to throw Kansas also in there. Missouri's in there in the top 25. Texas, though, looked so good last week in that first half.
If Texas is able to continue undefeated and go to the Big 12 championship game, just hand them the national championship trophy, the gauntlet that they have to run through here in the last or the next few weeks.
And Joe Gans just wants to take a knee. They want to go into the locker room, but they are trailing 20-17. The big star in the game, though, has been Robert Griffin. He's thrown well. He's run exceptionally well. Bo Pelini's defense at times looked a little confused. And Lewis is with Coach Art Briles.
All right, Coach, describe the way this team has played the first half on the legs and the arm of Robert Griffin.
You know, I think as a team, we're playing extremely confident, and we're playing with a lot of emotion, and we have to. So that's what we're going to continue to do. We hadn't done anything yet. We realize there's 15 more or 30 more minutes out there. We got to, you know, be better than what we were this first 30, but we've given ourselves a chance, you know, so that's all you can ask for.
All right, Coach, thanks. We'll see you in the second half. Ron?
All right, Lewis, 20-17 is our score. Coming up after the break, the Craftsman Halftime Report with Ted Robinson and Roland Williams right here on Versus. One half is in the books, and the Baylor Bears are happy what they see. They have got the 2017 lead over the Nebraska Cornhuskers, along with Kelly Stauffer, I'm Ron Thulin. It is very simple when you look at this game. Robert Griffin, and
simple
Robert Griffin.
Simple for you, not for
Nebraska. What is going on with Nebraska defense that they're allowing him to gash him for two runs of 40-plus yards?
Well, obviously, that was one of the keys, is to keep him in the pocket. When he's out of the pocket, good luck. But as you can see right here, the Nebraska is trying to the zone read. Cody Glenn gets caught up inside, and what's that allow is Griffin to get to the perimeter. They can't allow him to get outside the pocket, and this is just a blunder. It was a quarterback sneak. You have to anticipate where the quarterback is going, but don't give up on where you see him go. And then right here, you have to get pressure, as we see Pierre Allen doing on that play. Robert Griffin has had too many open receivers with a young quarterback that's accuracy is questionable. Throwing deep, you can't allow guys to run free.
Three of his rushes totaled 99 yards. Now, you have to take away some of the sacks. That's why he has 8 rushes for a net 93 yards. Offensively, Nebraska has to feel good about themselves, but it's the defense that seems to be the problem.
Yeah, I think Nebraska's offense needs to challenge this Baylor secondary. They need to go deep early and often and expand the field as we start this second half. And absolutely, keep Mr. Griffin in the pocket and make him do something with the football deep. Don't allow him to throw the short passes. I mean, that's the order of the day. Now, doing it is a little bit more difficult than us just talking about it up here.
I wouldn't be surprised if Sean Watson, who says they want to be creative, they want to color outside the box, starts pulling some of his little tricks out here in the second half. the second half with the football. They'll begin first and 10 from their own 20. Right before the start of the second half, Lewis Johnson caught up with Bo Pelini.
Well, your defense has given up almost 9.4 yards per carry. So how do you slow down Griffin in that 234 yards of total offense they put on you guys in the first half?
You don't miss assignments, you don't miss tackles. And we've done both. And when we execute, we'll be just fine. We just, we got to execute better.
That's bottom line.
All right, offensively, what do you do differently?
I think we're doing some good things offensively. We just got to eliminate a couple of the negative yardage plays. And I think we'll move the ball well in the second half. I like our plan.
All right, thanks.
All right, Lewis, I think the key, though, what he said was they've got to tackle better, because we saw Asante miss a tackle. We saw a couple of guys miss tackles that should have been made, which would have stopped big games.
Well, Bo and Carl talked to us about that. They design defenses. They can get players in the right position, but obviously they can't make the tackle for them, and that's what Nebraska is having to do, execute this game and then finish the play.
Now, talking to some of the personnel that are watching this game about what Bo Pelini was so upset about in the first half, we think it is formations. He's concerned about Baylor's formations. Pass intended for Geddes off the back of the head of the Nebraska Cornhuskers. Asante was turned around. So was O'Hanlon from that free safety spot. There's a great story, Matt O'Hanlon. Here's a young man that enrolled in South Dakota. He was a high school quarterback and running back, or actually he started to go to practice, never did enroll. Said, listen, I want to play for the Nebraska Cornhuskers. Walked on. They call him a mental player. That mental player got a scholarship this past September. He is a true success story, the junior out of Bellevue, Nebraska. Third down and two for the Bears. Empty backfield. Griffin looks, throws, passes, knocked down. Phillip Dillard had the big meat hooks on it, the junior out of Jenks High School in Tulsa, Oklahoma.
Well, that's a great example of Baylor's offense under Art Briles really not being able to take advantage spontaneously of voids in the defense. Mm-hmm. I circled the void in the defense. Nebraska wasn't lined up right, but Robert Griffin's play right now is very orchestrated, and he could not take advantage of the left side of the defense.
As we watch tape of Griffin, don't get us wrong, he's talented, but sometimes the creativity is limited because they're trying to protect him. The punt by Epperson. Ooh, made it a little dicey there. The 39-yard kick is finally brought in by Nate Swift. Let's take a look at our Volkswagen in-game recap here on Versus.
And we already talked about Robert Griffin getting outside the pocket. He's been efficient at throwing the football again. No interceptions, which he hasn't had any in his career at this point in time. And Gans has been very good, and they possessed the ball. Nebraska almost doubled up Baylor in time of possession. Mm-hmm. But the bottom line is they just didn't finish the one drive that really is the difference in the game. But the story is on the defensive side for Nebraska. They have to find a way to make better decisions in the secondary.
Hey, look at Gans's numbers in the first half. Pretty good. 16 of 22 for over 100 yards and a touchdown. Now he gets another opportunity. Had a man wide open. Karinsky Gilliland, the redshirt freshman out of Leander, Texas, who they think is going to be a star, couldn't get the meat hooks on it.
Gillian was wide open in the flat, and that's what Gans has to get better at. Your short passing game, which right now Nebraska is doing, that, you know, kind of the screen game to about 10 yards, it has to be almost perfect, because it's really an extension of your run game to try to loosen up Baylor.
Well, Nebraska holding Baylor to just 49 seconds of offense to begin quarter number three. Trying to do something themselves. We've played just about a minute. Marlon Lucky up over the 35-yard line to the 36-yard line. Pick up a three on the play. They'll set up a third down and seven situation.
And that really was just a maintenance type of up down and distance to get third and a little bit more manageable. But right now, Nebraska has to look for a way to loosen up the Baylor defense. Drive the football, yes, but loosen up. Don't be afraid to take your shots.
Baylor's been averaging about needing 4 yards on third down. This is third down and eight. 6 of 10 in the first half on third down for the Huskers. Gans checking things off. Two wide receivers to the right. Has plenty of time. Has a man over the middle. Todd Peterson First down, Nebraska. Up over the 45 to the 47-yard line. Pickup of 12 on the play.
Nice design of this play by Sean Watson. The quarterback, Gans, starts on the other side of the field, knowing all the while that Peterson is going to be over the football at some point in time, and that really becomes his outlet receiver after starting on the opposite side of the football field.
I think what we're waiting to see is something that they've shown the last couple of weeks. No hesitation on offense. They're not showing any hesitation in this series. Lucky over the right side, gets into Baylor territory down to the 47-yard line. Antonio Johnson, 7 tackles already in the ball game.
We go take a look at that last play. Look at Gans start to the right side, and he feels Peterson to the left side, knowing all the while that that's really his secondary outlet. If it isn't clean on the first look to the right, you come back to the left, knowing that he's going to be setting at that third down yardage.
After the pickup of 4, 2nd and 6. This time, Lucky stopped in the backfield. He's going to lose a couple on the play. Maybe got back to the line of scrimmage. Jason Lamb came up with the first hit. Joe Pavelic is the one who cleaned it up. You see 41 Pavelic out of Smithson Valley High School from an outstanding high school program outside of San Antonio. Larry Hill's the head coach. And this guy was also an outstanding baseball player, a catcher. And he actually thought he was going to play at Baylor for a while.
Leading the conference in tackles coming into this game, but Nebraska did a very good job up front of getting ahead on Pavelic in the first half of this football game.
On 3rd and 5, here comes some pressure. Gans reads it, getting away, and enough for the first down. Down to the 40-yard line is Mike McNeil, the tight end. That is such an advantage, having tight ends like McNeil and Young that not only block exceptionally well, but also have good hands.
And what McNeil does is sit down over the football, number 44, at first down depth. And if he's clean, you give it to him. If he's not there, then you have to go to something else. But remember, it's about managing the game,
yep,
converting on third down, and moving the chains.
4 receptions for McNeil this afternoon. He's got 18 on the year. Fresh set of downs for Nebraska. Play action. Gans runs away from the pressure, throws off balance, and does the wise thing as Antonio Jones was pressuring him. And that was a smart heads up play by Gans. Just get rid of it.
And those are the decisions that Gans is making better this year than he did last year. And remember, this is only Joe Gans's 10th or actually 11th start of his career, even though he is a senior. But that's what you do, managing the football game. Sometimes the defense wins and you have to throw the ball away and line up on the next play.
You know, and I think that's what the fans were cheering about, because they wish he would have thrown it away against Texas Tech in overtime.
Let's talk about that. Let's talk about that play a little bit later. We kind of have a difference of opinion.
Yeah. Okay, Gans looks into the flat. Pass caught inside the 40, down to the 37-yard line is Niles Paul. Here's that Texas Tech play. He gets twisted around, and we were talking to him yesterday, and he just winced when we asked him about it.
And he actually had Holtz going up the outside down the after the fade route, and Holtz was holding up his hand, meaning I'm going to continue to go on. The safety was coming over from that 2-deep coverage, so there was nowhere to throw the football, and he was just a little bit late throwing the ball away.
I know that's one of those you wanted to string back on it. Gans, little pump fake there. Heads to the sideline, and he is horse collared. And there is no flag. He was grabbed by the back of anything on the shoulders.
And if you're not going to call the horse collar in this situation, then you're never going to call it. This is exactly what it's for. And he might have been just a little bit too far down on the jersey right there.
Yeah,
I think actually seeing it on replay, that's actually a very good call. But that's where people get hurt, when you grab the back of the shoulder pads and pull them back over themselves, is when you start to get those ankles and knees getting turned loose.
Well, now Alex Henry's going to try a field goal. This is going to be a 52-yarder. And the ball just bounces around, and Baylor saying, stay away from it. Now, the officials have not ruled the ball dead yet. Now they do. Jason Lamb coming in to block Henry's field goal, only his third missed field goal of the year. Jason Lamb, the junior out of Berkner High School in Richardson, Texas, making his 26th consecutive start, and he gets the big meat hook on that one. All 6'6", 270 pounds. He beat his block. That allowed him to block the field goal, so Baylor takes over. First and 10, ball's on their own 35-yard line, leading by a field goal. Finley got back to the line of scrimmage. Let's go back to the block.
Well, look at the overload right here, and the penetration is going to come right there. And the young right tackle, Marcel Jones, and the deep snapper, does not have anyone to block. He should block out to that overload. There was plenty of guys to block. It just wasn't communicated very well.
Griffin looks over to the side, and when he looks over to the side, Nebraska likes to change up their defense to try to confuse the true freshman. No confusion here. He wants to throw it out of the flat. Has his man complete. Thomas White tiptoes down the sidelines. Got the first down up to the 49-yard line.
Well, you notice the effect that the running game has had on Nebraska's defense right here. This play has hurt them in the first half, so this is the next thing in the progression that comes off of Baylor's offense, is then they start throwing off that zone read. That's what makes this offense trouble. They like to run the ball first about 61% of the time.
White, 13 consecutive games, at least one reception now. He's got a couple today. First and 10 from the 49 for the Bears. Griffin looks. Here comes the pressure, and he's going to throw it away before he goes down. Good coverage by the Nebraska secondary.
You know, Ron, one of the things that we talked about yesterday with Nebraska's defensive staff, Bo Pelini, Carl Pelini, is you need to get after this young quarterback, but you need to be aware when you rush. You don't want to be under control, because then you're less aggressive. But right now you see that kind of out of this Nebraska defense. They're kind of setting back a little bit because they know at any time Robert Griffin, if he gets outside, he can gash him big time.
That was an incredible stat you just saw there. Five touchdowns, no interceptions. Griffin, plenty of time, has a man wide open. This could be six. It is right, and he gets down inside the 10-yard line. They'll mark him out at about the 7. Larry Asante's the one that stopped it, but Kendall Wright, the true freshman out of Pittsburgh, Texas.
And Wright was actually in the backfield. He runs a wheel route, go to the flat, and then turns up, and Nebraska just completely drops him. Dillard, number 52, the middle linebacker, was chasing him, but obviously a little bit too late. And this is what Art Briles brings to the table. He uses his personnel in a lot of different ways. Wright's the leading wide receiver coming out of the backfield and wanting a real wheel route. It creates an advantage in matchup with your Baylor.
After the pickup of 44 this time, Griffin, not much running room. By the way, that last catch by Kendall Wright, he has the freshman record for receptions in Baylor history. He came in with 33, now has 36. Breaking Brad Taylor's mark.
Ron, you remember yesterday when we talked to Carl Pelini, he talked about the need to recognize personnel if you're Nebraska's defense. Baylor does a lot of things with different personnel and formationing. Nebraska has to recognize what personnel is on the field, and they didn't get Kendall Wright in the backfield to play before.
That's Jacoby Jones in the backfield. Griffin keeps it himself, stood up at the 4-yard line, but able to lean forward down to the 1, Phillip Dillard. Griffin is slow to get up here.
He is.
He's very slow to get up.
It looked like the defender kind of fell on the back of his leg as he drug him to the ground. It looks like he's limping maybe on his right leg that time. But I think Nebraska has to run their defensive scheme on that zone read, giving Griffin a give read, meaning take it out of his hands. Do not let the best athlete on Baylor's football team beat you here today in Memorial Stadium.
Well, Baylor waits till the play clock gets down to two, and then a timeout is called. 6:29 left to play in quarter number three. The Baylor Bears surprising the Nebraska Cornhuskers, and they're moving again.
Go Baylor!
Third down and goal from the 1 yard line for the Baylor Bears, already leading 20-17. Jacoby Jones now moves over to the left. Griffin stood up at the 2 yard line, bringing up a fourth down. Zach Potter, Larry Asante combined to make the stop.
This is what Nebraska has to do. Notice they're taking Robert Griffin away. He's not getting in the end zone. Nobody out here on the pitch, guy, but that's what you have to do. Make Robert Griffin, the young quarterback, get the ball out of his hands. He was unwilling to do it on that play.
This will be a 20-yarder for Ben Parks. Comes in 4 or 5. He hasn't missed from this distance this year. And it hits the goalpost, and it is no good. Looked like it was also tipped by Pierre Allen. Allen gets a piece of it. It's no good. Baylor comes up empty.
Once again, Ron, and Baylor wanting to seize the momentum, and Nebraska comes up with a big play. You can see a little bit of penetration, just fingertips on the ball, drives out a little bit left, and that's just enough to bounce it off the upright.
He's been fairly steady so far, the true freshman, Ben Parks. He won the job in the preseason. They like this young man's future, and they should. He's been outstanding, but now Nebraska takes over from their 20. Trailing by 3. Baylor over 300 yards total offense. Nebraska 232. Helu makes his way up to the 23-yard line. The sophomore out of Danville, California. He's a guy that, if you look at Robert Griffin, looks like his ankle might be okay. Nobody's working on it as he came up a little. Hopping on that. Lewis, you got more on Robert?
The only thing I can tell you is he's sneezing a lot. I don't know what that means, but Griffin is not taking any attention to that ankle. But in that timeout, Ron, we saw him on the field there with the trainers as he was kind of rolling that left ankle around, and he jogged off pretty slowly. So we'll watch him and see if he takes any other attention.
Well, it didn't look like it bothered him too much on that last run. Gans running away from the pressure. Niles Paul with the reception. He's got a first down for Nebraska up to the 35-yard line. Then Atchison on the coverage.
And Paul's going to sit outside at that first down marker, and Peterson is inside. Gans takes a look inside, nothing there. This is your control route right there. Get it out on time. Get a little bit of yardage after the catch. But those are the type of things that Nebraska has to be very buttoned up in, particularly Joe Gans.
And Nebraska looking over to the sideline. I think they're going to call a timeout. They're going to burn one, too. So Baylor burned a timeout here in the third, and Nebraska's burned a timeout. 4:47 left to play in quarter number three. The Baylor Bears 20-17 over the Nebraska Cornhuskers. This is how their pass attempts have shaped up so far today.
And we can see all the passes down here, the screen game and the short passes. You have to get downfield here more often. And if a defense is playing soft and not allowing you to do that, you have to do it by design and creativity. Mm-hmm. Create a shot play to loosen up this Baylor secondary.
And they have to do it. And we were both kind of surprised after that missed field goal attempt. Maybe they're not doing a little more of that.
You can hear it again. Means audible, kill, kill.
Swift dropped it. That would have tied Johnny Rogers' mark for receptions. And he dropped it instead.
And Ron, we heard that Gans at the line of scrimmage saying, kill, kill. What he's saying is, the play that I had on is completely wiped out right now. I'm going to something totally different, a new concept. Because a lot of times you go kind of a check with me system at the line of scrimmage, meaning we're going to run this. Or we're going to run that. If I want to go to something totally different, I say kill, kill, and that means different concept is now on the table.
Now Helu splits out wide to the right. They empty out the backfield. On second and 10, the quick look in, pass caught by Peterson. And he's got a close to the first down. I think they're going to mark it right about the 45, maybe a shade over as Peterson comes up with his third reception. Jake Lamar and Jeremy Williams combined for the stop. How about that Texas Tech score? 63-14. In Oklahoma now leading Kansas State 55-28. And the big game coming up in a little bit in Austin at Memorial Stadium. Of course, Oklahoma State and Texas. Wow. Big 12 can put some points on the board.
No kidding. You better play a little bit of defense.
Yeah.
Yeah, Kansas has absolutely no pass rush, so it was only going to be a matter of time before that got ugly.
And that is a first down by Anats Eyelash. Let's check in with Lewis.
Right, here's an update, Ron, on Robert Griffin. Right now you see him talking to one of his teammates, but just a few moments ago, the trainers came over, took the tape off of the outside of his shoe, removed the shoe, added more tape over the ankle that he already had to try and, I believe, give him more stability. Then they put the shoe back on and then re-spatted the shoe, which means they retaped it on the outside. First time he's taken medical attention, and we'll see now if it's going to affect his wheels out there on the field.
I'm going to ask Kelly about that after this play. Gans from the shotgun, fresh set of downs.
Hey, short, 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 short.
Doesn't see much pressure. Goes to his safety in the flat. Peterson again makes the catch. Right at the first down marker again.
And a great job by Joe Gans, really going from one side of the field to the other. His first receiver all the way probably to his third or fourth pick. Peterson on the opposite side of the field. Good job of going through your progression as long as you have the time for. You have the pass protection, which you did on that play.
As a quarterback, when you got your ankle retaped tighter, does that bother you?
No, it didn't bother me, but you talked about asking me a question about wheels. You're asking the wrong guy. Robert Griffin is the guy to ask that, but I don't think it will matter one bit.
Now Swift wide to the right. Another first down for the Huskers. Gans. Plenty of time. Out into the flat. Was he in bounds? No. Stepped out. On any given Saturday, anything can happen, as we have seen. Coming up next, it's an Ivy League showdown as Dartmouth takes on Columbia. And then in a couple of weeks, on November 15th, it was one of the most stunning upsets in the history of college football. The Stanford Cardinal beat the USC Trojans, the best team in college football. Now the rematch. USC-Stanford, Saturday, November 15th versus college football. It's wild out here. Eight different receivers have caught passes for Nebraska today, nine last week.
And in the first half, Nebraska completed 60% on third down, but their average was only 4 yards.
And that pass is dropped. It is not a lateral. Gilliland, again, his second drop.
And see, that's the point, Ron. In the first half, Nebraska was 6 out of 10 on third down conversions, but their average to gain was only 4 yards.
Mm-hmm.
In this half already, they've been 8, 9, 10, 11 yards because of mistakes just like that.
Well, they were hoping to get him more playing time, but with two drops today, that playing time may dwindle.
It evaporates in a hurry.
Yeah. Bo Pelini, he doesn't like that. Those are the little mistakes he talked to us about yesterday, that momentary lapse in concentration that they've had in a couple of games this year. This is a big third down. Third down in a bunch. It's 10. Gans running away. Doesn't have anybody open. Looking. Finds somebody open. Pass caught by Swift. He has tied Johnny Rogers' mark for receptions in Nebraska history.
You talk about mobility at the quarterback position. Baylor comes after Gans. Gans gets outside the pocket and continues to focus downfield. Do not drop your receivers and turn that into a running play prematurely. Great job by Joe Gans.
And you see the numbers. 143 receptions now for Nate Swift. Great job of him coming back to the quarterback on that play. First and 10, the drive is alive with 3:10 to play in the third. Lucky keeps his balance, able to get down to about the 22-yard line. Pickup of 7 on the play. Looked like Joe Pavelic is the one that got a little piece of him. Pavelic with 5 tackles today.
Pavelic's having a little better second half.
Yeah.
In the first half, Nebraska did a good job up front at getting up to the second level and getting a hat on Pavelic, but he's a tackling machine, so you would look for him to be more active in this second half.
Only 2 tackles in that opening 30 minutes. Second down and short now for the Huskers. Gans keeps, gets a block. has the first down inside the 15, down to the 11-yard line.
Ball carried by Joe Gans.
Ron, that's one of those times when Joe Gans, he had room to run on the last play, but he gave it. And he goes back to the huddle and says, you know what, I had room. I may keep it the next time, and that's exactly what happens. Coach, do the play over again, and I'll take advantage of the defense this time.
Nebraska 14 in a row scoring in the red zone, 12 touchdowns, a couple of field goals. This goes back to the Missouri game. Try to make it 15 out of 15. Swing it out, Niles Paul ducks inside down to about the 8-yard line, 5 yards on the pickup. Great block by Nate Swift.
Oh, yeah.
And we were talking to the coaches. I talked to Ted Gilmore. I said, you got your wide receivers blocking.
Which offensive coordinator Sean Watson said is they like to get guys to the ground, at least a couple of knockdowns a game just in the screen running game. There's one of them right there for Nate Swift.
They're on the 9-yard line, inside of 1:30 to play in the third. You hear Joe Gans changing the play again. Kill, kill. Peterson moves in closer. Gans looks, throws. Touchdown, Nebraska. And Nate Swift is the all-time leading receiver in Nebraska history. What a catch by Nate Swift. 8 catches in the ball game. Second week in a row he's accomplished that feat. The extra point. It is good. So after the missed field goal by Baylor, Nebraska takes it 80 yards and they take the lead.
Well, we know that Nate Swift is a receiver that blocked in the option a lot of times. He's the inside receiver. Cut him to the ground. Some running room on the screen, but we know he can catch the football as well. Option number one for Gans is the comeback in the corner of the end zone. There he is. Nate Swift runs a very nice route. Welcome to the record book.
And he went over immediately and congratulated Joe Gans. Patted him on the head. Like, thank you. What a career for the senior Nate Swift. 12 plays, 80 yards, just over 4.5 minutes. Joe Gans on that drive. He gets kudos from Ted Gilmore, the wide receivers coach. Gans was 6 of 9 for 61 yards on that drive. Gans now 25 of 36, Kelly. Pretty good day.
You see Nate Swift become the number one guy. Johnny the Jet Rogers, he's not second in much of anything in the history of Nebraska football. So, and that's back in the day where they didn't throw it as much. But don't get confused. That was the Jerry Tagge
era.
That's
exactly right.
They threw the ball a plenty back then.
Next week, the 1971 Nebraska team will make their way to Owen Field in Norman as Joe Castiglione, the athletic director at Oklahoma, bringing everybody back who played in that outstanding game of the century.
Man, growing up in Northwest Nebraska, that gives me chills as Johnny the Jet Rogers walks in, and hopefully we can get him on here a little bit later.
He's coming in our booth right now. And it'll go into the end zone. Now it's time for our Prestones protecting the quarterback. Kelly.
Well, there are a lot of ways to protect the quarterback, but Nebraska has done it. The short passing game, get rid of the ball, change the launch point, meaning get your quarterback in different areas to release the football. In the pocket, give him a good target to throw to, step up in the pocket when there's pressure, and then the play action also protects the quarterback. Multiple ways to protect Joe Gans.
The crowd is into it now. Griffin keeps it. Slips by a couple of tackles, still on his feet. What a run again by Robert Griffin. He's gotten him out of trouble a number of times, and we've got a Husker down on the field. That run, 19 yards. And it looks like Phillip Dillard is the one who's down, and he's holding his right ankle. The junior out of Jenks High School in Tulsa, Oklahoma. He was injured where he couldn't play the Texas Tech game. Came back last week versus Iowa State. You got a couple. Clayton Severs also kind of probably hearing a couple of phones ringing in his head right now as he goes off. The senior out of Elkhorn, Nebraska. They call him the blue collar guy, but Dillard, who is just an outstanding middle linebacker, is Nebraska had to replace all their linebackers this season, which is something they haven't had to do in a long time in their history.
Well, that's
the first time since 97 they had to replace all of them.
That's how Cody Glenn got on that side. He was going to be a running back probably deep in the depth chart, trying to get maybe 5 to 8 plays a game. So go on the other side and maybe you can play the whole game. So they can't afford a lot of injuries at that position.
See what happened here. Looked like he got hit by his own guy. Looked like Cody Glenn may have gotten him.
I think you're right, trying to pursue and get a hand on Robert Griffin, and they collide, and Dillard got the worst of it, apparently.
Well, the backup is Colton Kohler, a junior out of Harvard, Nebraska. And Griffin with 58 seconds left in the quarter. First and 10, 39-yard line. Nebraska showing blitz, now they back off. Cody Glenn changing the defensive signals. Plenty of time to snap it. Let's go the other way. Here comes Griffin, pursued by 4 red shirts, and he is going to be ushered out of bounds and has to jump over the bench. Cody Glenn showing some of that running back speed, chasing him out of bounds.
How about that hurdle, guys, over the bench?
Yeah, how was that for him, Lewis?
That looked like the Olympic trials again, huh?
I wasn't quite 400 meters, but it was close to it. He started clear on the left side of the field, doubles back, and Cody Glenn can close the gap a little bit, too. You see why he can run.
That was perfect. Cody Glenn forces the 5-yard loss. Second and 15, 15 seconds left in the third quarter. They have to snap it. Griffin, 3-step drop, looking, firing. Pass is going to be incomplete. 1 second left in the quarter. It was intended for Kyle Mitchell, the junior out of Denver, Colorado.
A great job by Nebraska's defense, kind of playing a little bit of cat and mouse. Are we coming? Are we not? And that time, Nebraska got the best of him. Great job on that whole series by Bo and Carl Pelini calling those defensive plays for this team.
Final play coming up in quarter number 3. And it is loud. A little razzle and dazzle. Kendall Wright tries to get to the outside, and he is going to be dropped after a short gain. And he looks injured. But Nebraska, an 80-yard march, capped off by Nate Swift's touchdown reception, becoming the all-time leader in receptions in Nebraska history. And coming up, we will have the man whose record he broke, Johnny Rogers, as we head to quarter number 4. Final quarter straight ahead, and Nebraska leads it 24-20. And joining us is a man that needs no introduction here in Nebraska, Johnny Rogers. Okay, you had your record broken, but I'll say you played one less year than Nate Swift did. Okay, I throw you a little props
okay.
there, right, big guy?
All right, thank you.
How do you feel about him breaking your record?
Well, I talked to Nate here the other night, and I told him to definitely go for it. We're all proud, all the alumni is proud of the work that he's done, and we want to keep those records out there to be broken. We want to set the bar high so more kids will come to the University of Nebraska to help build our program, and he's done a great job, and so we're all proud of him.
Now we'll take a look at this play first and get back to Johnny Rogers trying to keep it. We got a flag on the play. Swift again, this time going down the sideline. Swift inside the 30-yard line, and he's got a little bit of inspiration on him, and it might be roughing the kicker coming up.
I told you we were proud of him.
There you go. Okay, now we saw that from Nate Swift.
Roughing the kicker.
It was
defense.
Roughing the kicker, so it's coming back.
Penalty,
I got to ask you, all my Oklahoma fans, I used to do a radio show with the late Jack Mildren, and he swears there was a clip on your punt return back in 71.
Not
so does Joe Wiley
fan.
Told me.
Steve swears it. Billy Seale swears it. Every time we get to Oklahoma, they swear.
But you don't think so, huh?
No, we looked at it several times. Joe Blaha, I think, is the run that the guy they're talking about. And you can see when he turns her around, all the whole circle and comes back around and gets him. But it was at your field. I can see if it was a home game.
Yeah. It's their fault if the flag didn't come out on their field. How has the game changed since back in those days in the early 70s?
Well, more people are playing from the pro in the spread right now. We did a heck of a lot less passing than they do today. And the plays are faster. The guys are faster. It's just a wide open game now. Yeah. A lot more scoring.
And Griffin gets away again. Look, what do you think about Robert Griffin? You're watching this freshman. You've been watching him break all these long runs. The quarterback for Baylor. What do you think of his ability?
Well, I'm not sure if he's breaking the long runs or our guys just aren't tackling.
Yeah, I think a little of both.
Yeah, I've been amazed at that. But he's a heck of a football player. We always say you have to have big plays in football, and he makes big plays quite often.
Well, that's a position that's changed a lot in overtime in football, the quarterback position.
And I think it's going to start changing more in the pros too, because you have to be able to run as well as to throw, and these guys are able to do that now.
Yeah.
Well, Johnny, we appreciate you stopping by, and I know everybody's looking forward to seeing you as they kind of recreate the 71 OU Nebraska game coming up next week. But it's always great to talk to you.
I can't wait to get down there to a boomer. Sooner.
All right. I'll talk to you next week, Johnny.
Thank you so much.
Right.
Thank you.
One of the greats in the game and a true gentleman, Johnny Rogers. We appreciate him stopping by with us. Baylor's second down and eight, balls on the 35-yard line. Griffin looks. Cuts back. That shows his escapability. He's able to pick up a couple of yards, and Cody Glenn comes out with the football, but the official saying he was down. Tyler Wortman on the stop.
Cameron Meredith was out there too from his defensive end position, and you saw once again missed tackles. And what you cannot do with Robert Griffin is overreact. You have to approach him and then come under control and try to make a tackle. Not a knockout shot, just try to bring him to the ground.
Well, the fans saw it on the Jumbotron. They thought it was a fumble, and I think they're going to take a review of this. I think the official got buzzed, or both. Bellini's challenging it. Let's look at it again. Was it a fumble? Well, Nebraska is challenging the ruling. I can't see it, Kelly. That's hard to see. Let's look at it again. Boy, that's tough to see.
And remember, the review, the replay officials have the same angles to look at, obviously, what the TV provides. So they're looking at the same kind of stuff.
Boy, Griffin,
and I not only did not see that football out, but I didn't even see the football. So it, you know, inconclusive video evidence. They can't overturn it if you don't see it conclusively on the replays. I didn't see anything conclusive there. Did you, Ron?
I didn't see anything on that. That's tough. But Bo Pelini is challenging it, and the officials are going to look at it again. But I didn't see anything that would make me think, wow, they've got to overturn this. Once again, Griffin takes quite a wallop here by Cody Glenn.
That's the one thing I talked to Art Briles about, is you have a young quarterback, a true freshman, that's still kind of maturing body-wise. He's not real thick yet, and he takes a pounding. But they said designed runs, they want him to have 8 to 10 to 12 a game, but he takes off a lot outside of the design of the play where he takes a beating.
Well, now the officials are making double sure. You know, we also had some clarification with some of the officials about that punt in the first half, and it was not conclusive that the ball was touched by a Baylor player early in the first half. Those of you who remember it thought that it may have been a fumble. They said the ball did not go right or left and didn't squirt either side, so they felt they made the right call on that one.
Well, the problem I have with that, though, they then spotted the ball wrong as if it touched a Nebraska player, which makes their first point invalid.
Yeah, they said it touched the Nebraska player after we thought it hit the Baylor player. That was kind of the explanation I was given. Well, here's the call.
The ruling on the field has been confirmed. Third down.
We were paged by the replay booth before Nebraska challenged the call. Therefore, they are not charged with the timeout.
Oh, so Bo dodges a bullet on that one. Not charged with a timeout because they were buzzed by the replay officials before he had a chance to challenge it.
And it might have been one of those plays where the ball's loose in there, but you can't really tell it. And we certainly couldn't see it on any of the shots that we saw.
Third down and four from the 31. 13-11 to play in the ball game. We've got a whistle and a timeout, Nebraska.
Timeout, Nebraska.
Bo and Carl Pelini come out to the field to talk to their troops. Art Briles comes out to meet his, and Bo is in the face of Tyler Wartman. We'll take a break.
College football on Versus is brought to you by Prestone. Your inner car guy knows. Only Prestone is Prestone. And by Holiday Inn Express, the hot breakfast bar in town.
Dr. Tom Osborne, the legendary coach, now athletic director, who took over last year. And when he did, these Nebraska fans took a big sigh of relief because they felt they had one of their own running the show again. One of his first hires was Bo Pelini. And right now, Pelini's squad leads it 24-20. Just about 2 minutes gone by here in the fourth quarter. Baylor third down and four on the 31.
This is the guy that Baylor is trying to pressure. Do I stay out with these trips and coverage, or do I get back inside and become a run defender?
Nebraska shows blitz. They bring five. Griffin, a little touch pass, incomplete. That was intended for Thomas White, who was really nowhere near it.
It's hard to tell if White and Griffin, they obviously weren't on the same page, but whether White ended up running the wrong route. But interestingly enough, yesterday when we were talking to Carl Pelini, he said, you know, that we want to take away short passing game. We actually want Griffin to have to prove that he can be accurate down the field. And he has been at times today when he's had wide open receivers.
Baylor going for it. They're one of one on fourth down. Griffin, here comes the pressure. And he is going down back at the 35-yard line by Larry Asante. Nebraska leads it, 12:53 to play in the ball game, along with Lewis Johnson and Kelly Stauffer. I'm Rob Field. Good to have you with us today. Just a reminder, every ride is critical and every second is tough, and it all comes down to this: the PBR World Finals. The best Cowboys and the rankest Bulls square off in the PBA event of the year. $1 million purse and the cherished golden buckle are on the line. The PBR World Finals, live from Las Vegas, start October 31st, only on Versus.
Ron, we're talking about it at the break, that Baylor, after a timeout, when it looked like Nebraska was confused,
yeah,
obviously not on the same page, not a very good effort after a timeout when you have all kinds of time to talk about it.
It didn't seem like White and Griffin were on the same page. Gans has a man wide open, but throws it out. It was intended for Todd Peterson. Boy, it looked like Peterson just had nothing but daylight in front of him.
You know what? I think Joe Gans actually gave up on that play just a little bit early and was throwing the ball out of bounds. I think if you lead Peterson more up the field, I think he had a chance there.
Joe Gans today, 25 of 37, 185 yards. Trying to have 13 straight games this Nebraska offense of 200 yards passing.
He's killing another play. It means we're going to a totally different concept.
Gans, a quick look in, incomplete. Off the hands of Nate Swift. And the officials are going to convene on this because we have a penalty flag. Boy, it's way back here. It's way back on the 40-yard line.
We have a sideline interference violation against the visiting team. 5-yard penalty. Third down.
Some of the coaches in the Pac-10 affectionately call this the Mike Stoops rule.
Yeah.
You know, and actually, Bo Pelini's been called for it this year. He actually was got so far out that an official ran into him during one of their first three games.
It's a safety factor for the officials. But the big change is there essentially is no warning anymore.
Right.
It's a penalty right away, but there's plenty of warning going on. Rest assured that quietly the officials have said a few times already, hey, guys, back up or I'm going to have to flag you.
If I'm an official, I don't want to hit the former DB at Ohio State, Bo Pelini. Third down and 5 for the Huskers. Ball's on the 40-yard line. Dan's 3 wide receivers to the right. Pass to Peterson, complete, and he's got the first down. He made the catch right at the first down yard line, Kelly, and was able to stretch forward a couple of yards. He's been solid today.
Todd Peterson and Nate Swift do a very nice job. They're not exactly fast, but they're quick in little spaces. They don't generally take the big hit, and Peterson avoided a big one on that play.
Peterson this afternoon, 5 catches, 50 yards. Had a career-high 8 receptions versus Texas Tech. Fresh set of downs for the Huskers. Gans pump fakes, looks, has a man, wide open, inside the 20, 10, touchdown, Nate Swift.
Nate Swift has caught the slant route a few times already. Well, guess what's coming? You jump the slant like Brian did a little bit earlier. You pump the slant and you throw behind it. Perfect setup because Nate Swift has already caught that same slant play run probably a half dozen times on the afternoon.
And he has cracked the century mark in receiving. 9 receptions, 108 yards, 2 touchdowns. And the extra point. Whoa! No good. That is the first miss by Alex Henry in his career. Time now for our pot busting flashback presented by Buffalo Wild Wings. Today we look back at 14 years ago.
In a battle for the 1994 national championship, Nebraska trailed Miami 17-7 in the third quarter at the Orange Bowl. Could Tom Osborne's Cornhuskers make a comeback? You make the call. A Tommy Frazier touchdown pass and a Corey Schlesinger run gave Nebraska a 24-17 win over Miami. It was the third of 5 national titles for the Cornhuskers. Brought to you by Buffalo Wild Wings.
And you go into the Nebraska area down here at Memorial Stadium, you see the 5 national titles, 43 conference championships. They're one of just 5 schools with over 800 wins. Wow. And they've got some hardware down there, including all the Heisman trophies.
Yeah, they do.
Swift, 7 consecutive 100-yard games, 9 catches, career high for Nate Swift. By the way, Alex Henry's first missed extra point in a Cornhusker uniform just a moment ago. Baylor trying to get on track down the kickoff up to the 31-yard line. Mikhail Baker, let's go back to that touchdown again.
Well, Nate Swift has got a lot of slants just coming inside right here, and this time he's going to slant and then he's going to turn it up the field. There's the slant, get the defensive back to step up. When you see his feet change and jump that route, that's when you go by his outside shoulder. Great execution of the play that was set up a long time ago.
Well, Nebraska has come back. And Baylor continues to run the football with success. Prior to that play, they had been very successful running the ball, over 200 yards rushing in this game.
Well, if I'm Carl Pelini, I'm making number 32, Jay Finley, carry the ball the rest of the afternoon. I'm not letting Robert Griffith, the quarterback, who's electric when he gets out in the field, I'm not letting that guy beat me this afternoon.
No. First down and 10 from the 42, inside of 12 minutes to play. This time, Corral, no, still on his feet is Finley. And he gets up to midfield.
Ball carry by number 32, Jay Finley.
Luca Mara is the one on the stop, but how did Finley get out of that?
That's a good question, and rest assured, Bo Pelini's going to ask that about Sunday night. a couple of Huskers on that play that just fly by. They don't wrap up. Sue was one of them, and he's been great on the year, but that was a poor effort.
This time a big pile up right at midfield. It is second down and short, and I don't think they got it.
Gripping the ball carrier.
Yeah, Ron, I think you're right. I think it's going to be third and about as short as it was on second down. Remember what Robert Griffin did on the quarterback sneak earlier in this game. Do not count on him going inside. Right. If you overcommit inside, he has the ability to bounce it outside and take it a long way.
Which we've seen him do that a number of times today. He has 120 yards rushing. Third down and two. And we've got a timeout by Baylor. That'll give them one timeout remaining in this ball game. Tuesdays and Thursdays Versus is stirring the soup with the new original series, Sports Soup, hosted by comedian Matt Eisman. Featuring the week's best highlights, lowlights, and everything in between, we're covering the coverage with a hilarious show that sports writes. Sports Soup, all new every Tuesdays and Thursdays at 10, right here on Versus. Well, one of the things Bo Pelini wanted to do is when he took over this program is he wanted to get back to the tradition. And part of the tradition of Nebraska is getting the homegrown Huskers. You can see two from Cozad, from Grand Island, one each from Elkhorn, Loomis, Harvard, Lincoln, Ralston, and Bellevue. Seven players from Omaha, of course, the state's largest city. 68 total players on this Nebraska team. They had 12 walk-ons last year, but a program that was so important in the Tom Osborne era has returned because they have 30 walk-ons this year. And as somebody who lives in Nebraska, you appreciate that.
Absolutely. The saying used to go that the heart and soul of this Husker program comes from right here in state. A lot of times you get the feet and arms elsewhere, but you get the heart and soul right here, the corn-fed Nebraska boys. Bo Pelini knows that quite well.
Here we go, third down and two. Kendall right in motion. Finley stacked at the line of scrimmage, and he is actually going to lose a half a yard. It all started up front with Ndamukong Suh.
I don't like to call it all, Ron. If you're Baylor on the road trying to make something happen, I think you have to get your electric quarterback outside the pocket by design and let him make you a play. At this point in time of the game, to hand it off straight ahead, you got to be kidding me.
0 for 9 on third down today, Kelly, for this Baylor team. And they're going to be forced to kick it away again. Kicking with the wind, and this is a boomer. And it's going to go into the end zone. Nebraska will have it on the 20. We've got 10:23 left to play in the ballgame. The Huskers have got the advantage.
What makes this place special is that there's 1.7 million people in the state that feel an ownership in the program and feel like it's one big family. And obviously the walk-on program has a lot to do with that, and how the players, you know, the type of players you bring in, what you ask them to do, the accountability that they have to everybody who's a Husker fan.
And that includes the 84,000 plus that are here today that are the Husker fans. Here's Marlon Lucky, left side, up to the 25-yard line on first down. He picks up five. You know, getting back to that tradition, and I've spent a lot of time with Bo, as you have, Kelly. You know, you find that this man not only understands the tradition here in Nebraska, but he embraces that tradition here in Nebraska. He wanted to get the integrity back into the program. He gave the players ownership of this team. The Unity Council has stepped up, and that is very important for him, is people understanding this tradition and becoming a family with it. On second down and five from the 25-yard line. Lucky's got the first down and one to spare.
Well, I think the thing about Bo Pelini coming back here to Nebraska, because remember, he was here once before. There was a coaching change, Frank Solich out, which meant Bo Pelini out. He got really a token interview by Steve Peterson, the AD at the time, and a lot of people were very disappointed that they didn't make a better effort there. But I talked to Bo about that very thing, and he said, you know, quite frankly, I don't know that I was ready to be a head coach then. I went away for a few years. I learned a lot. I was ready now. I'm ready for this challenge.
He is a rock star, though, when he won at the Alamo Bowl. On first and 10, Gens looking deep, has a man again off the fingertips, intended for Peterson. He wanted a flag. He's not going to get it. Let's check in with Ted Robinson with an update on Georgia LSU. Ted.
Yeah, Ron, this SEC showdown. First play from scrimmage. Jarrett Lee's pass picked off by Darryl Gamble, who runs it back 40 yards for the pick six. But LSU has gone right back, and they're inside the Georgia 10, Ron.
Hey, Ted, when you play games, big games in the SEC, defense-oriented, it generally comes down to turnovers.
That's right.
Will you bail the offenses out by turning the ball over?
Closing in on 9 minutes to play in the third quarter, second down and 10, and we've got a whistle and a penalty flag. Okay, I'll give you the question.
Prior to the snap, delay of game, number 12 of the offense, 5-yard penalty remains second down.
I'll give you the question because it's been a huge argument this whole week. SEC, Big 12, better conference.
I think SEC plays incredible defense. Obviously, the Big 12 plays great offense. I would like to see that matchup. One conference's offense against the other's defense. But I think top to bottom, I give the nod to the Big 12 right now. I think right now the SEC's down at the bottom of that. And I think that's why the improvement by teams like Nebraska, the Big 12 wins out at this point in time.
And with the improvement of Baylor, that's only going to help this conference. Joe Gans steps up in the pocket. He's going to be hit from behind and drop back at the 25-yard line. That was just a solid defensive play by a couple of Baylor Bears. Earl Patan in there, Joe Pavelic in on there. Let's look at that again.
A good job initially by Joe Gans stepping up in the pocket, but then you have to know where the door's open and how quickly do I have to get out. It's open to the left. He just needed to hit that escape hatch just a little bit sooner, but good effort by Earl Patan on that play.
Well, the last five games, Nebraska has given up two sacks in each of those contests. Patan's got one of them today. Lucky over the middle of a little screen. He's got some running room. What a move to the outside. It's a foot race. Lucky out at the five.
And the inside screen to Marlon Lucky turns the defender loose, turns around for the ball. But it's the blocking of tight ends and receivers down the field that turned that from a 8 to 10 yard play to a 69 yard play. In particular, Drew Young, the young tight end number 49, a great block downfield.
Longest play of the season for Nebraska. I thought Trenton Hill was going to break an ankle the way Marlon Lucky put a move on him. Gans looks. He's got some green in front of him. Ducks his head. And he has stood up. The bumble ball is fumbled. And I think Nebraska got it back. Gans took a shot at the 1 yard line. Lost the football. Drew Young comes up with it. And we have a penalty flag also. No, I guess we don't.
It almost looked like Joe Gans didn't know whether he wanted to go airborne on that play or try to lower his head and get across that goal line.
We saw Nate Swift go airborne last week at Iowa State. I guess he saw what happened to when he did
and
that.
And looking at Gans right there, it looked like he might be favoring his right shoulder just a little bit after that big hit.
How about that red zone offense? They've been perfect going back to one of the final series of the Missouri game. And
I think this time
you're right. Look at him kind of moving that. His left shoulder's not moving a whole lot. Well, that's because he's maybe looking at some plays. Well, we've gotten to know Joe Gans over the last 2 years, and we're going to introduce you to Joe Gans and his personality.
Joe Gans, quarterback. My favorite non-football athlete, besides Michael Jordan, probably Jenny Finch. My iPod would be a little bit of everything. You'll find country or real heavy metal rock. Yeah, that's probably about it.
Got that Chicago attitude working, doesn't he?
That's right.
I'll tell you, you know, we've gotten to know him. He is such a personable young man. And he really has grasped this leadership role.
Yeah.
And you look at what he's had to go through. He's always been the backup to Zach Taylor, to everybody that was ahead of him. Sam Keller last year.
You see the zero interceptions in the red zone as a starter in the trips down there. Makes great decisions in the red zone.
Second down and goal from the three. Castillo lowers the head. And he loses the football, and Baylor may have come up with it. Yes, they have. Joe Pavelic comes up with the loose ball.
A lot of times, Ron, ball handling for young running backs is the last thing to come around, and Castile just doesn't secure the football. He gets undercut, tries to jump over the top a little bit, but you have to hang on to it. I don't mind playing a lot of running backs when you have young, talented guys, but I like Marlon Lucky, the veteran down there, when you have to close out a game.
Well, Castile has had fumble problems. He dropped a pitch in the San Jose State game that he had about 60 yards of daylight. The coaches have been concerned about it, and talking to Tom Osborne about it, he said, Bo Pelini's told him, you got to tuck the football. He's had some problems. Let's see if the Nebraska defense can stop Baylor. That's going to be a safety. Colton Kohler, the junior out of Harvard, Nebraska.
Once again, if Baylor isn't going to do something abnormal down here, you just tee off and get after the running back as Nebraska does with Finley right here. Robert Griffin is not going to throw the ball out of his own end zone if he's had the harness on him out in open field. So Nebraska just tees off and makes Baylor pay.
In the first half, Baylor had six drives. They had three touchdowns and three punts. In the second half, they've missed a field goal, a couple of punts. They lost on downs, and now the safety. And Quentin Castile has just taken a big sigh. I guarantee, though, that Bo Pelini and Sean Watts are going to be all over him, because here's a young man, Quentin Castile, who they want. They said after the first couple of games, we got to get this guy back in the lineup. They've given him the opportunity, but you can't cough up the football like that.
Yeah, he brings a dimension that really Marlon Lucky does not bring. He's the thump guy. He's a big body running back at 235 pounds, but big fella, you want to get on the field, you have to hang on to the rock.
And he even talked to Sean Watson, the offensive coordinator, after the Texas Tech game and said, what's my role? He said, we want to get you more carries. A Bo Pelini squad now goes up by 12 with inside of 7 minutes to play. If they win today, they will equal their record from last year as far as wins. This would be Nebraska's fifth victory of the season.
And very important as you try to get to that sixth, so you become bowl eligible with Kansas State and Colorado still to come.
And the free kick by Baylor, and again, it's a capital U, ugly. And we've got a penalty flag. I think it's probably for kicking out of bounds.
Yeah, you, if you're Nebraska, you send your offense out there right now to take advantage of some momentum. No re-kicks.
No. You know, you look at Baylor, they played such an outstanding first half. Griffin was just remarkable, and ever since he twisted his ankle, he's only done a couple of things, but not quite as explosive as he was in the first 30 minutes.
Kick out of bounds on a kicking team. 5-yard penalty from the inbound spot. First down.
And Nebraska will get good field position.
And Ron, what you talked about with Griffin, I think, is true, the nicked ankle. But I think Art Briles has to kind of loosen it up a little bit at this point in time of the game. With his young quarterback, everything is very deliberate and orchestrated,
right.
But you have to let him go and see if he can make a few plays for you.
Well, now Nebraska takes over. Ball on the Baylor 47-yard line. Here's Lucky, stood up at the 45-yard line. Pick up a two. How about an update on Georgia LSU, you ask? Here's Ted with that.
Now, Ron, Jared Lee tossed a pick six to start the game, but rebounded, brought LSU back on a 72-yard drive. The touchdown pass to Brandon LaFell ties the game. Ron?
All right. Huge as far as BCS implications that game down at LSU. 6:28 clock is running here in Lincoln, Nebraska. Seventh biggest crowd in Nebraska history. Have seen Nebraska fall behind at halftime and really put the brakes on this Baylor offense in the second half. That's why they lead it 32-20.
Two tight ends in the game. This means we're going to milk every second off the clock we can.
some safe pass up to the 40-yard line. That'll be a pass complete, number 87. Or down to the 40. That'll be a pickup of four on the play. Set up a third down and about three for Nebraska.
Ron, what Sean Watson, the offensive coordinator of Nebraska, has settled into is you have a quarterback in Joe Gans that makes great decisions. You have Nate Swift and Todd Peterson, sure-handed receivers that understand the passing game. So they throw a lot of that short stuff as an extension of their run game, and it keeps the defense honest. Remember, Sean says we want them to play 52 yards wide, and that's a good example of it.
Nebraska 455 yards total offense this afternoon. Oh, a little shuttle pass to Lucky. Got a defender hanging on him. Any given Saturday, anything can happen. And coming up next, as soon as this game is over, it'll be an Ivy League game with Dartmouth taking on Columbia. And then don't forget, on November 15th, it will be the rematch between USC and Stanford versus college football. It's wild out here.
You talk about a love of the game. You get into the Ivy League, yeah. You start playing in there, you have to love what you're doing.
Well, fourth down and one, Nebraska's going to go for it, as you might expect.
I look for him to be very right-handed right here.
Well, I don't know if Gans tried to get it.
I think the initial surge, the push up
Vincent
front.
Vincent Rhodes, the senior out of Denison, Texas.
It's a very favorable spot.
When they came from the far side to make the spot, I thought, oh my goodness, he got that far?
Yeah, but Matt Slauson up front, Murtha, Hickman, got a great push up inside. Williams, the left guard.
Let's see where they spotted it. Boy, it's tough to tell from up here. You know, you look at Big 76, Murtha missed a couple of games. He had a leg infection. He was honorable mention, Big 12 last year. And when they got him back in the lineup, you've got 3'15", 6'7", at the tackle, 6'5", 3'20", with Slauson at the guard. You want to run to that right side. He didn't get it. First down, wow. Baylor, good stop by the Bears. Here's Lewis with more on Art Briles. Lewis.
Yeah, Ron Kelly, you know, Art Briles is probably thinking right now, you know, how did this game get away from us? And remember, we talked to him earlier in the week, and he said that the program is making strides toward that strong image and recruiting. But they're inside the Big 12 family. He said not outside, but the deal is you got to win. You've got to sustain anything positive, because when things go bad, the Baylor family's going to remember the bad times, but you got to win. So be thinking about how this one got away from them today.
Now Griffin winds up, throws, hit as he lets it go, looking for Kendall Wright, and it is incomplete. You know, just picking up on that, talking to Coach Briles even this summer, and coming up for this ball game, one of the things he said, we need to get some doggone respect from people, and the way you do that is you win. And they have to get a couple of victories, he was telling us, that will make people say, did that really happen? Now remember, this is a guy that took over a Houston program that 2 years earlier was 0-11. And he made him very successful. He will do it at Baylor.
Where that winning has to come is on the road here in conference play. That's where it gets ugly for this Baylor program, is when you get on the road in conference, the wins just absolutely evaporate.
Second down and 10 from the 37 for Baylor. Robert Griffin has done his part this afternoon. Has some time over the middle. That was the arm shortening up by David Geddes.
Geddes wanted no part of that pass over the
football. You see those arms? They kind of started withdrawing real quickly there.
Alligator arms. No, thank you. I'll take the next one.
No, yeah, really.
One thing that has happened here in the second half I think is important. Baylor did a great job of winning on first down in the first half. They averaged 12.2 yards a play on first down in the first half. In the second half, it's gone under 5 yards on first down. You don't want this young quarterback to have to consistently win on third and long.
Now Geddes goes wide to the right. Was there movement on the right side? Ty Steinkuhler thought so. And the officials are going to make sure they get the call correct. I didn't see movement. Now the flag is actually sitting over at the 45 on the far side of the field.
prior to the snap, illegal substitution against the defense. 5-yard penalty, remains third down.
Okay.
The substitution rules are the same for both sides of the ball.
Right.
You cannot start the huddle with 11 or take one off the field late, and that's what Nebraska tried to do to get the right personnel on the field defensively.
Six penalties for Nebraska. That's kind of been the Achilles heel for them this season. Third down and short. Griffin pitch. And that may, we got another penalty flag as Finley gets close to the first down.
Penalty flag on the play.
And the penalty flag is back at the 40-yard line.
Illegal chop block, number 71 of the offense. 15-yard penalty, replay third down.
Ron, this is another point of emphasis for officials. The chop block, which means that a defensive player is engaged up top, and then you can't get an offensive player coming down below at the same time with simultaneous contact. Happens right there. Just the right hand sticking out there by Bernard, and then Gay comes low. That's a chop block. It didn't look like much, but that's it by definition.
Good point. Point of emphasis with all the officials this season. Third down, now it's 20. Griffin looking, winds up, lets it fly. This one's hanging in the air a long time, and it's going to be incomplete. Murillo on the coverage to Geddes. As Kelly mentioned earlier, he's the speed guy. That ball just hung up in the air.
Once again, Ron, we see that Baylor gets behind and down a distance. Nebraska's done a much better job of winning the first down matchup, unlike they did in the first half, and it's forced this Baylor defense to play from behind and down a distance. They haven't been successful at it in the second half.
122 yards for Baylor's offense here in the second half after 234, and this is a rocket. Hits at the 7-yard line. Swift takes a chance, 64 yards on the kick, 8 on the return. Yeah, we got two first-year coaches, first-year head coaches in the Big 12, and a couple of other guys. Paul Johnson, what a great job he is doing for the Yellow Jackets. And you look at the rest of them, and Bo Pelini, the only other one notable that we have as far as a winning record. 18 new coaches, and a lot of them are struggling, but that's, you kind of expect that sometimes.
Yeah, you really do. You have that transition period with the new coaching staff, and you have new recruits coming in. You usually have a void in that recruiting class when you take over for the first time. So all those nuances add to that trouble.
You would expect Nebraska is just going to keep this on the ground to keep the clock running. Lucky over the left side. And they are just 3 minutes and 43 seconds away from their fifth win of the season. And they go to Oklahoma next weekend.
Oklahoma, and then they come back here for Kansas on November 8th and then finish out with Kansas State and Colorado. That's why this fifth win here today is important. You want to get to six. You figure you can at least split with Kansas State or Colorado at least, maybe at worst, but you don't want to have to become bowl eligible by beating Kansas and Oklahoma.
And I think they're probably going to have a little confidence going into that Kansas game. Of course, first things first with OU, but what happened to Kansas today? Versus Texas Tech is Swift with another reception. He's got 11 today. What a day for Nate Swift. He breaks Johnny Rogers' record for receptions in a career, and he's just piling it on now.
And how about the confidence in Joe Gans and Nate Swift in hooking up? Because Sean Watson says, you know, we do want to run off the clock, but we're not afraid to throw the football right here.
Well, he talked about imagination, Sean Watson did, that they want to have more imagination on offense. The players actually have an input. He says, listen, we listen to them. It's not like he goes, might as well have a suggestion box on my desk, because they tell us what they like. We try to figure it out where it'll work. Gans will throw again to Peterson. And he gets up over the 35-yard line as the clock goes inside of 2.5. Bryan on the stop. Now let's look ahead for Baylor, because the Bears now will go to 3-5 on the year. And it doesn't get any easier for them next week. They got their homecoming at home against the Missouri Tigers. But this is a guy that's got to play at Art Briles. He's got a facility that's going to be opening up, and that just will be immensely successful for this Baylor recruiting efforts.
The football program is going to be on campus. Yeah. They have to drive to the stadium to practice, and the players kind of felt disconnected from the rest of the Baylor community.
As they should have. That'll be a first down for Nebraska inside of 2 minutes. This is going to be beautiful facility for the Baylor Bears. The higher athletic complex at Simpson Center. They're going to have the football offices in there. They'll have places where they can work on their academics, the training room, the coaches' offices, and no more driving 3 miles to Floyd Casey Stadium to watch tape. They can just walk from their dorms now and watch tape.
And what Arbroz told us earlier in the week is we want the football program to become a productive part of the Baylor family. And I think that's a great step. Get the student athletes playing this game on campus with everybody else. That's a great step toward that.
Pinball action. Jason Lamb on the stop. You know, we were talking about the pass attempts and what Nebraska is going to try to do. Here's the way it ended up right now.
Nebraska started, everything was down here, and slowly they worked their way up to the mid-passing range, and then they started to loosen things up a little bit more right here. Sean Watson says, we want the defense to defend 52 yards wide and vertically as well. I think they covered that pretty well today.
Well, this should be the last play of the ball game with 47 seconds left. Joe Gans throwing for 336 yards this afternoon. 7 300-yard passing games for Joe Gans.
I think the Huskers have a skosh of momentum in this program right now. Bo Pelini just talks about now the reality is do everything you can to maintain it. I think Bo Pelini is headed the right direction.
Absolutely. Two wins in a row after that crushing defeat to Texas Tech. Says we're making steps. We're not anywhere near what we should be right now, but this team is getting that Nebraska tradition back. And Nebraska's going to win it. The final 32-20. Stay with us for our next game, Dartmouth and Columbia, with Rich Ackerman and Dale Hellestray coming up after a minute break. Our final score, Nebraska 32, Baylor 20. For Kelly Stoffer, Lewis Johnson, and our entire Versus crew, I'm Rob Doolin. Have a great afternoon, everybody.